Hello, Dr. Speck. How are you, sir? If you could unmute, please. We can't hear you, sir.
Unmuted. Okay, sorry. My
Thank you.
apologies. I completely missed that. I'm just kidding. I'm so
Yeah,
sorry.
it's all right, so no worries. How are you? Nice to see you. We can hear you well. We can see you well. The only thing I'd like to
Good.
ask of you, sir, if you could make sure to turn off your microphone and camera while I'm playing the recorded file, so we won't have any interference. And then after we finish your recording, Dr. Scheidt will be the moderator for your session, and it will tell you the questions from the audience. Thank you. So you can close your camera and microphone from now
Okay,
on.
so after my recording is done,
I'll send you a request. You'll see in the
just
Zoom
turn it on then
to
after
turn
the.
on your camera. Yep, and then we go to a live Q&A. So.
Okay, sounds good. And hopefully the internet doesn't freeze like it did during my recording.
I'll keep my
As I said,
fingers
here in
crossed.
Silicon Valley, we're just discovering. Well, very good.
Well,
Oh, good. I'm again getting the message that my internet connection is unstable. So fingers crossed today.
fingers crossed. Yeah, worst case scenario, we still have your recording and people will enjoy your lecture.
You might have any chance. Are you on a wireless right now connection or on a wired?
I'm on a wireless.
You have a
Unfortunately, with this
wire by
portable
any
computer, I
chance?
don't have a way of hooking it up.
It's
Oh,
a
no, I don't.
okay.
So, well, this way too, if I get a question I can't answer, I can just pretend to freeze.
So if there's anybody else in the office or home or wherever you're at who's using the internet, maybe just during the live Q&A, may I ask for the internet just for yourself. So if there's anybody on Netflix or something like that, we can ask them. You're muted again. I can't hear you, sir. Sorry.
Sorry, it just kicked me out and then got me right back in.
Yeah, there's some internet stability connection. What I would recommend, sir, is to, if you're on your laptop, close every browser and every app that doesn't need to be open at the moment. And
Okay.
if there's somebody else sharing the bandwidth on in the house or office wherever you're at,
Yeah.
maybe
Do you
just
have
ask for the internet for yourself then.
what about on your cell phone? Do you have internet on your cell phone? Can you turn off the wireless on your cell?
Why don't I shut down? Yeah, why don't I shut down my cell phone today?
No, not the shutdown. You just turn off the wireless so it's
Okay.
not
Yeah. The
eating bandwidth.
Wi-Fi.
Good
Yeah.
idea. Okay, I'll do that. I've been checking emails during this through the phone, but I can go quiet today. As I said, when we've gone through the round robins, I've had no trouble with the connection. But the
Yeah.
way these things usually go, it's when I go live for this sort of Q&A, that's when it's going to strike. So.
We'll
And
keep
it's
our
like my
fingers.
dog. He knows when I'm going to have a meeting or a Zoom. Excuse me. And he starts to bark.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, we've been doing lots of Zooms here, and as I said, periodically there'll be a freeze. So oh, I hope you're okay. Yeah. I'll probably do the same thing during Q&A.
It's all
It's
right.
terrible when that happens. Okay, so I will shut
All
off
right.
the
Yeah, you
Wi-Fi on
can.
my phone,
Yep.
and
You
we'll
can turn
hope.
it off. You can still check your mails, just not on the Wi-Fi. Just use the 4G or 5G, whatever you have over
Yeah.
there.
Okay.
All right.
All
Thank
right.
you
I'll
very
do my best
much, sir.
to have no
Thank
glitches.
you.
Okay. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thanks for meeting
Take
me.
care. If you could
Okay, you
close it.
too.
Yep.
Hey,
Close it.
thanks for great support so far. This has really been a great meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much,
So
sir.
happy to help. Thank you so much.
I appreciate all your help. Thanks.
That was so nice.
Okay, ready it if you could. Okay, close your camera as well. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the third day of training in neurotherapeutics discovery and development for academic scientists. Okay. Well, we're at the midpoint of the course. You've heard a lot so far about the need to develop a formulation for your neurotherapeutic product in order for it to be able to be administered to a patient and to reach, to enter the body and then reach its ultimate target in the body. We have two experts in formulation as faculty members in the course this year. You'll be hearing first from Dr. Maureen Donovan from the University of Iowa. Dr. Donovan will be speaking about ordinary methods of formulation and routes of administration. And then second, you'll be hearing from Dr. James Cloyd, who is at the University of Minnesota, and he will be talking about alternative routes of administration for administering your neurotherapeutic. So we'll begin with Dr. Donovan's lecture.
Morning. I'm happy to be here to talk to you about formulation considerations for proof of concept and first in human testing. And this is an important step along the pathway to drug development. And so what I want to do is help frame a little bit where actually I'm going to be talking to you and where formulation considerations start to become important. In your drug discovery and drug development endeavors, usually, and many of you are probably involved in these very early stages, drug discovery stages, trying to identify the molecule that you want to or consider to be the best molecule to move forward into therapeutic testing and potential commercialization. So lots of chemistry work being done here, pharmacology work and so forth. And in many cases, using very rudimentary type formulations for the drug to do this testing, and that's just fine. You stay simple, you don't have to worry about regulatory filings and so forth at this stage. Where I'm going to be focusing most of my presentation, the situation where you're entering late stage development, where you need to begin to think about doing proof of concept testing in humans or first in human safety testing. And at that point, you actually do need to start considering what your formulation for your final drug product will be, but certainly what a formulation that's capable of being administered to humans is and how you're going to accomplish that. So in later stage development, you're still doing pharmacology and toxicology testing, and now we have to start considering how to formulate for both toxicology testing and for human use. Those formulations become more complex. They're intended to bridge into that final drug product. And we start seeing the need for following regulations regarding final drug product approvals and so forth. So things get just a little bit more complex as we move forward. But before we get too far into formulation and drug development, I wanted to emphasize a couple of important points about almost all drug molecules that we consider and try to help identify what their potential formulations might be. So a couple of basic rules to start with. Rule number one is the drug molecule needs to be in solution to be absorbed. And that's a standard. There's some exceptions if we're going to talk about particulate matter and acidic uptake, but we're going to leave those aside and think about molecular level drug absorption and molecular level receptor interactions. In all of those cases, the drug has to be in solution to interact as we need it to. And typically the media that it's going into solution in is an aqueous-based media. So intracellular fluids, extracellular fluids, gastrointestinal fluids, and so forth, all aqueous-based. So we get very concerned with aqueous solubility of our drug molecules. And as we'll see in a couple of slides, one of the other things we get concerned about is their lipid solubility also, because to be absorbed, they have to pass through these phospholipid bilayer cell membranes, and that gives us different characteristics that we need to be concerned about. So let's talk a little bit more about solubility, though. And in the case of solubility, it's a number. You can measure it in various situations. But what's really the important aspect to solubility in drug development is, what is your drug solubility relative to what dose do you need to administer? Because what we're the goal is to be able to have the drug in solution when it is in the region of its receptor, or in solution so it can be absorbed if we're not directly injecting it intravenously. And then the question becomes, well, how much drug and what volume is it that I need in order to administer that drug in solution? So I've listed a couple of commonly used administration routes. All of these we use solution dosage forms. Some of them we can also use suspension dosage forms, and so we have a little less concern with the absolute solubility issues if we're going to use a suspension. But at some point, the drug still has to go in solution, so we can't ignore it entirely. But I've given you an idea of what a typical volume would be for administration at a site, which means that your dose would have to be in solution in 200 microliters, for example, for an intranasal administration. That's pretty challenging in many cases. For intravenous and subcutaneous use depends on for a single injection, the volume needs to be relatively low, a couple milliliters potentially. For infusions, we can get by with larger volumes, but typically we don't make the drug product in that 1 liter volume. We make it as a different type of product that gets injected into a 1 liter fluid volume that then is administered and so forth, adds a little bit more complication than just thinking about, I'm going to put my drug into a liter of fluid and have that as my final drug product. Certainly a possibility, but not as common. But think about the dose relative to the volume at the administration site. I've added oral administration in here just as a reminder. We can give oral solutions, certainly, and about 30 milliliters is usually about the maximum volume somebody wants to absorb or wants to swallow. We can also give oral suspensions and so forth. But the key being, we have to keep in mind, again, the drug has to go in solution to be absorbed. And as a result, we need to consider its solubility in about 250 mils of fluid. That's a reasonable ballpark volume for different regions of the gastrointestinal tract, especially the regions where we do see good drug absorption. We have more volume than that in the entire gastrointestinal tract, so we've got a little bit of latitude. But if we at least start with, is there any conceivable way that the dose could be solubilized in 250 mils of fluid, of water in particular, that helps us with strategizing a formulation or the need for some potential alternative formulations. Now, many of you are probably used to using non-aqueous solvents, especially in very early preclinical investigation. DMSO in particular is a very common solvent that drugs get put into to do a number of early tests. Unfortunately, DMSO is hardly ever used in humans. So already you face the issue with, you can use a non-aqueous solvent, but you have to consider the amount that is potentially approvable in a regulatory situation. So even something that we might consider as biocompatible as ethanol has regulatory limitations. And currently about 4 milliliters per day of ethanol is about the maximum volume of ethanol that we typically see being approved for use. Now, we all know that we can ingest more than 4 milliliters of ethanol safely, but it's a matter of, can we inject that volume safely? What are the consequences? Again, the current regulatory standards give us less than about 4 milliliters. So we don't have a lot of ethanol to work with, propylene glycol, glycerin, kind of similar situations. So we can't rely on just using our drug in solution in a non-aqueous solvent as the potential formulation. It's unlikely that that will be approvable in a regulatory situation. So once we wrestle with solubility and how to maximize it, or considerations we're going to have to take regarding the formulation because our compound is low solubility, we also need to consider somewhat the opposite. We need to consider its lipid solubility also, because we need to know that it has capabilities to be able to partition across cell membranes. And this is sort of a classic example of partition coefficients versus the permeability of a molecule, in this case across the brain capillary epithelium. And in the permeability is essentially the velocity. It's a centimeters per second is the units. The velocity, the rate at which a molecule moves across this barrier, in this case, the brain capillary endothelium. And its partition coefficient, it's the ratio of the concentrations between an octanol phase, a lipid-like phase, and a water phase. And what we see is we see higher velocities or higher permeabilities for these more are these higher partition coefficient, higher log P, more lipid soluble molecules. So estradiol with a log P above 3 shows really, really good permeability. Unfortunately, estradiol also shows really, really poor aqueous solubility. So there's a balance between those two factors that gets us into the sweet spot for the kinds of characteristics that we would really like to have for our drug molecule. Unfortunately, most drug molecules aren't in that sweet spot, and we have to identify formulation tricks potentially to try to enhance some of those properties. One last general property I want to talk about before I start getting into more details about formulation is chemical stability. Now, during your drug discovery phases, you're going to be involved in looking at biochemical stability, metabolic stability of the compound that you're interested in. The other thing from a formulation standpoint you have to be aware of is the need to be able to verify chemical stability, that your molecule is stable, doesn't degrade under the typical conditions, and certainly doesn't degrade in the formulations that you're going to be using for toxicology testing or for human clinical trials. So early in the development phase, even before you get to a reasonable activity level for formulation, you need to identify a method to demonstrate chemical stability of your drug compound and have an awareness of what its likely degradation products are. We use a number of different methods, certainly HPLC, LCMS methods are extremely common. And the many, many compounds are prone to instabilities. And as a result of that, we have a number of formulation techniques to try to address those. And so I've listed a few, there are quite a few others, but all of the techniques are specific to the type of chemical instability your molecule is prone to. So if it's prone to oxidation, the inclusion of antioxidants may improve its chemical stability in the formulation. If it's not prone to oxidation, including antioxidants doesn't make any sense. And so we have to know specifically about the compound and the degradation pathways in order to make good intelligent choices for the kinds of fixes we want to improve the chemical stability of the formulation. So I'm going to talk a little bit about general concepts and approaches in formulation, and I'm going to start with the perhaps hopefully most straightforward formulations, and this is again just straight solutions or potentially a suspension. And what you'll notice on a number of my slides is I have a tendency to try to remind you graphically to keep it simple, scientist, that most of the time in early formulation development in proof of concept testing and so forth, keep your formulations as simple as possible so that you don't have extraneous formulation-induced changes that are altering the activity of your compound and making it difficult for you to translate your early preclinical findings into humans. So a simple solution, we hope, is the answer in most cases for early proof of concept study. Well, again, we have to worry about solubility of our compounds. And one of the things as we get into formulation development is we worry about solubility at a variety of temperatures, that if we have to freeze this material for stability purposes, well, then the solubility changes and we don't want phase changes. We don't want something coming out of solution as a result of some environmental condition we need for chemical stability. So solubility at a number of temperatures, we have to have sterile solutions for injection in particular. And as a result, the methodology that we use for sterilization can also induce chemical changes, chemical degradations. We have to account for that in our chemical stability profiling. pH changes can help solubility, they can reduce solubility and so forth. So we have to at least have some characterization and understanding. We have a little bit of flexibility at times in trying to get to a simple solution formulation. Suspension, similar, if we don't have adequate solubility, but we know we will once administered for good effect, well, then we can use a suspension, but then we have to worry about the solid material that's a portion of that formulation in particular. Typically, we can't put more than about 20% of the total volume as the solid in an injection system. It just won't inject through the syringe and needle systems that we're most familiar with. So we don't have a lot of latitude with excess solid, but we have a little bit. We have to worry about particle sizes because that affects how fast something dissolves. Sterility of a solid, assuring its sterility is much more difficult than assuring the sterility of a solution. So things can get more complicated pretty quickly as we add multi-phase systems. We might want to, you know, we might need to consider enabled or targeted formulations that we just don't have adequate solubility. There's no good way of administering the drug compound that we want to test. And so there are other methodologies, what I call enabled formulations. I'm not going to spend time talking about the details of any of these enablement strategies, but just notice that they're more complicated. Each one of these steps adds more materials that we have to consider, their characteristics and their characterization, in order to develop the formulation that's required in order to test it and assure its quality. If in the final administration to our human patients, we want to actually consider oral administration, we usually are going to think about solids rather than solution formulations, keeping in mind that once we administer that drug orally in the solid that we formulated, that it's still, the drug has to go into solution in the gastrointestinal tract and be absorbed. So we have some general standards for characteristics of materials that are absorbed well orally. No more than 5 hydrogen bond donors, no more than 10 hydrogen bond acceptors. These relate to the solubility of the drug compound and potentially a little bit about its lipophilicity. Smaller molecules have much greater propensity to partition well across cell membranes, and a log partition coefficient value less than 5. And if you remember back to that slide I just talked about with the blood-brain barrier capillary permeability, you noted that estradiol had a log P of a little higher than 4. And we know that estradiol has reasonably good oral absorption. It's got some problems with metabolism that counter its reasonably good oral absorption. But log P is less than 5, certainly oftentimes the target best properties give us log P's about 2 to 3, but that's more something that you'll wrestle with during hit and lead selection rather than during formulation. Formulation, we have to fix and address some of the limitations that the compound might have. Okay, for a proof of concept or first in human testing from an oral formulation, again, keep it as simple as possible. And in this case, as simple as possible is don't formulate it at all. Put the drug into a capsule and administer it. And if you know your drug has adequate solubility to go into solution in the gastrointestinal fluids and has reasonable permeability expected to be absorbed in the across the gastrointestinal mucosa, then let's just test the drug absorption itself and not worry about other materials that we might add to make that into a final formulation. Once you've gotten past proof of concept and need to develop a final formulation, there are other things you need to consider, and I'll talk about those in the next slide. But I will also tell you that oftentimes just a simple drug in powder already won't work because we know we don't have adequate solubility, for example. There are enabling technologies that we already use on or match to the drug compound itself, and those get addressed in this early stage as a result. So knowing about the chemical characteristics and solubility and compatibility with other materials helps us identify which is the better of these enabling technologies to try for those strategies. But as you're considering oral administration, you have a variety of different ways of administering materials orally. And this is just an idea of the additional materials we oftentimes add along with the drug. If we're going to make a tablet, we have to add some materials that we can actually compress into a tablet and have it stay intact as a tablet. And those are special characteristic types of materials, and they usually end up in this filler, glide-in, binder character, characterization scheme. capsules even. We see other materials that we get added in that help with dose uniformity, help with processing, help with high-speed manufacturing and so forth. May not really have any influence on the activity of the drug itself, but help make it much easier to manufacture and more reliably. But then we have simple things like, what material is that capsule body going to be made out of? And those, the capsule body can have chemical effects on the drug. They can have other effects that that make this an important selection. And I'll take you over all the way over to suspensions. I talked about suspensions for injection, but for oral administration, certainly a fairly common dosage form. Typically, we expect to flavor those. Trying to mask the poor taste of a drug. And I'll just caution you that flavoring agents are oftentimes very chemically reactive. And so even more considerations for our chemical stability issues. Many of you are likely going to be formulating macromolecules rather than small molecules. And I only have a couple of pieces of advice because macromolecules are complicated by their multiple structural forms that they need to retain for bioactivity. And we have to make sure that our formulations provide the macromolecule in the form or allow it to reform into its bioactive form once administered. So typically we don't worry about solubility of biologicals. Most of the current biologicals give us a good or sufficient solubility for injection or infusion, and that's typically the way that we're going to think about administering them. We don't worry about partition coefficient at all because these molecules don't partition well across cell membranes. They are taken up by receptors and so forth, and that their three-dimensional structure assists potentially with that. But we have to worry about their other primary, secondary, tertiary structure and retention of those. What I've given here is just a very general formulation categorization that we typically see with protein and antibody solution formulations. And what you'll notice is a lot of things that are labeled stabilizers. And the stabilizers and the variety of them are included because of the, primarily because of the secondary and tertiary structure considerations. And those are very different between protein molecules in particular. So which ones of these we would choose depend on the hydrogen bonding structure, depending on a number of other things. And so very general considerations, but not a lot of guidance because each protein, we need to understand how to retain its structures that are necessary for bioactivity. So my time has ended and I will leave you to review the summary regarding formulation. There are a lot of choices, but as you go through early proof of concept and first in human testing, restrain yourself from trying to get too elegant with formulation or tied into a final formulation. Keep your formulation simple so it's easy to understand the data readouts that you're getting and choose those formulations with the knowledge of how to bridge those into final formulations. And thank you very much for your attention.
Great, okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Donovan. We'll now move to Dr. James Cloyd. As you're aware, many times your drug products won't be orally bioavailable, and you'll have to be more creative and identify other routes of administration that could be used, such as intranasal or perhaps intravenous. And Dr. Cloyd will be talking about these alternative types of formulations.
Good day to all of you who are in the training program. My name is Jim Cloyd. I'm a professor and director for the Center for Orphan Drug Research in the College of Pharmacy at the University of Minnesota. And my focus is clinical neuropharmacology. I've done a number of studies in both animals and in patients and healthy volunteers with respect to CNS active drugs by various routes of administration. And today, what I want to do is follow up on Dr. Donovan's presentation. We're going to look at alternatives to the typical routes of administration one uses in early stage drug development, preclinical development, and discuss as you get closer to the submission of an IND, some of the options you can consider when further developing your product. So today I'm going to review these, what we call alternative routes of administration, particularly those that are applicable to CNS drug delivery. And at the end of this presentation, I'm going to give you some guidance as to when you ought to be looking for help and where you can go to find that help. And this is important because, as Mike Rogowski said a year ago, you don't need to be an expert in all aspects of preclinical drug development. But what you do need to know is how to talk the talk and have some idea of the various options that are available to you so as to ensure that you get drug to the site of action in an efficient and acceptable manner. So you've already seen a version of this from Dr. Donovan. And as you can see in the lower part of this diagram, one starts with a sort of simple process, making an IV or an IP or even an oral gavage formulation. These typically are not regulated, and they help you get your research started. However, as you move closer and closer to late stage preclinical development, you will need to give some consideration as to the route and the formulation you will want to use for the indication, the clinical indication for your drug product. And here, things will become more complex, and the simple approach of an IV, IP, or oral gavage solution may not be sufficient. And further, as your drug goes into early stage studies in humans, phase one, you may learn something about the route or the formulation that will cause you to circle back and perhaps do some other modifications to ensure you've got the right kind of formulation and you're using the right routes of administration. You've already heard something about anatomy and physiology, blood-brain barrier, the importance of lipid solubility, and the discussion Dr. Donovan led on formulation. So I'm going to largely focus on routes of administration. Now, a key to any drug product is that it diffuses across at least one, or in some cases, more than one membrane. And this, unless it's an active transport, occurs by passive diffusion. And Fick's law of diffusion identifies some of the factors that are important in determining the rate. Now, sometimes rate can be inconsequential, but in some cases, particularly for acute indications, rate is critically important. Diffusion coefficient is actually a characteristic of the tissue across which the drug needs to pass. Partition coefficient is a physical chemical characteristic of the drug. And this is related to Lipinski's rules that you heard about earlier, but is largely driven by lipid solubility of the compound. Another factor is surface area, and we're going to say a little bit more about that. And another factor is the gradient between the basal and apical sides of the membrane. The higher the concentration on the the capillary side, generally the greater the rate of diffusion. Now, as a general rule, the greater the absorptive surface area and the greater the blood flow, the faster the rate of diffusion. So let's take a look at some of the potential routes of administration and how the surface areas compare with each other. On the left-hand side, I have a diagram that lists most of the routes of administration that are available to you, ranging from literally injections into a ventricle in the brain, down to intrathecal, IV and intramuscular, buccal and sublingual. You can even use patch technologies. Oral delivery is by far the most common approach, but you can also use nasal and pulmonary delivery systems, and in some cases, vaginal or rectal delivery. Now, see how these alternative routes compare in terms of surface area. And the first one up is pulmonary inhalation. And you can see that the surface area measured in meters squared is huge. It's actually greater than GI tract or the brain. So following this law of diffusion, if the medical indication supported the idea of interpulmonary delivery, this would be a very effective way to get drug quickly into the bloodstream. But if you drop down into the smaller organs or tissue sites, such as intranasal, buccal, and rectal, you'll see you drop down from meter squared to centimeter squared. So you see a substantial drop in surface area, and that means that the characteristics of the drug you're going to use for your formulation have to lend themselves to these smaller surface areas. And in fact, the smallest area for absorption is intramuscular. And we'll talk a little bit about how you can address these potential problems with routes that have these small surface areas. Now, in terms of these emerging technologies that are available as alternatives to conventional IV and oral administration, we could divide these into two categories. The first category is what would be long-term drug therapy or chronic therapies. So you're treating some kind of condition, maybe it's a rare lysosomal disorder or some other fairly long-term medical problem. There, you can use implantable program pumps. And these pumps allow for constant or even variable infusion rates, and they can be linked in a smart way to a sensor so that the infusion rates will actually vary depending upon the need. And there are a number of options for this IV. You can use intrathecal pumps. There's even if you go with an external technology, subcutaneous. Other therapies that are possible are IM and sub-Q depot injections. And what this does is provide for very slow release of drugs, literally over months. Newer options include direct intracerebral ventricular injections, and I'll show you a couple of examples of that. And the last option in terms of alternate drug delivery systems for chronic therapy are something called protein fusion technologies. So let's take a look at one example. This is for an implantable programmable pump. The one I'm showing you is the Medtronic pump used for either pain or spasticity. And you can see that there's a pump and a reservoir system implanted in the abdominal cavity. And there's actually then a catheter that loops under the tissue into the spinal cord cavity itself, the spinal cord, and that tip of that catheter is placed where it will be most beneficial. And examples of this kind of pump include baclofen, which is intrathecal, morphine, which can be systemic or intrathecal, and then insulin, which is systemic. You can actually deliver drug directly into the brain, or at least into a ventricular area. And there's an approved drug that utilizes this route, Brineura, which is a lysosomal enzyme, cerebrolipinase by BioMarin, and it's injected into the brain periodically to treat a condition called CLN2, a rare lysosomal disorder. Alternatively, there are approaches to doing a direct intraventricular treatment to treat epilepsy. And these would be patients who have proven refractory to all the common anti-seizure medications, but where there may be some evidence that at higher concentrations, it may be possible to deliver the drug directly into the brain and attain seizure control. And this is an approach that's now under development by Cerebral Therapeutics, and they utilize a implantable pump, a special intracerebral ventricular port, and a delivery catheter to deliver VPA, valproic acid, into the ventricle. And this avoids the systemic side effects that are often associated with this drug. So these are exciting options that may be useful as you develop your drug. Lastly, I want to briefly talk about protein fusion technology, and this is an increasingly interesting area whereby one overcomes some of the barriers, some of the challenges related to the blood-brain barrier. And what is done is you identify a receptor on the blood capillary side of the blood-brain barrier. You then create an antibody that will serve as a ligand to that receptor and attach to it whatever pharmacologically active entity you want to get into the brain. It could be an enzyme or a peptide. You attach it, deliver the drug into the bloodstream. The combination product will then reach its way to the blood-brain barrier, attach to a receptor site, and then via endocytosis will bring the combination of the ligand and the active ingredient into and across the blood-brain barrier into the brain. And in fact, there are now a number of products that are being developed. Some are in late stage clinical development, in which this is designed to treat in a chronic way disorders on a long-term basis. Now, we can also look at alternatives to conventional IV and oral administration for acute indications. And by acute indications, I mean circumstances where you want to deliver drug as rapidly as possible to either prevent or abort a medical problem. In using these routes, one needs to consider the physical, chemical, and pharmacokinetic properties of the drug, because if that is not done, the approach may not work. Some of the technologies that are available include auto-injectors, and these now include actually needleless devices, and this can be used to administer drugs by an intramuscular route or a subcutaneous. And the beauty of these auto-injectors is that, of course, they can be done by the patient, they can be used by the patient or a caregiver, and we're all familiar with things like the EpiPen as an example of this, but there's a growing array of drugs that now employ these auto-injector technologies. Another option is buccal, and we'll show you a little bit about that option in a minute. Then you have pulmonary routes of administration, and lastly, we'll speak briefly about intranasal drug delivery. With regard to intramuscular administration, it can actually be quite effective in treating acute problems. This is an example of a comparison of intramuscular midazolam, which is shown in the purple line here, versus IV diazepam. This was actually done in patients. And the patients did have epilepsy, and the investigators were using spike activity as an indicator of how rapidly the drug reached the brain. Now, what's interesting, you take a look, there were two doses of the IM midazolam and two doses of the IV diazepam. They all are displayed on this graph, and they're clustered together such that the peak concentrations for IV and IM are virtually the same. And that indicates just how rapidly midazolam can be administered and cross muscle tissue into the capillaries and subsequently into the brain. Now, this is true because when midazolam injectable is given IM, it is rapidly converted so that the active drug has a octanol to water ratio of 475, highly lipid soluble. And this high lipid solubility allows it to passively diffuse across membranes. So if you have the right physical chemical attributes and you want to acutely treat a problem, it may be that an IM delivery system, particularly an auto-injector, may be a viable option. Another option is buccal drug delivery. And again, drugs that are considered for this need to be have the right physical, chemical, and pharmacokinetic properties. And there are various ways to do this. The most optimal way is to have some kind of drug delivery product, such as a soluble film, and I'm showing you an example of this, which can be attached to the buccal cavity. And in this scenario, the drug is released mostly through the epithelial tissue into the bloodstream. Some is also swallowed. And then in this particular example, the film is rapidly dissolved, so there's no leftover skeleton of the product. This is being developed as a potential treatment for breakthrough seizures or cluster seizures. And there's some information here below about a PK study that was done in adults, and it was compared with a rectal diazepam gel. So this may be another option for certain drugs for certain indications. Now, recently, work has been done on the use of a delivery system in which the drug is vaporized in this device, which I'm showing you on the right-hand side of this slide, and then rapidly inhaled. And then this vaporized particles, they're actually nanoparticles, get to the pulmonary alveoli very, very rapidly, and you'll just see how quickly this can reach the bloodstream. Now, the next thing I'm going to show you, this is the actual device. I'm going to attempt to actuate it and pay close attention to how quickly after a patient breathes, and that's all the patient has to do, the vaporization takes place. And it's gone and rapidly delivered deep into the lung tissue. And a PK study in which this device was used showed that peak plasma concentrations were reached in 2 minutes, which is frankly as fast as you're going to get with IV. And the panel on the right shows EEG changes occurring very rapidly after drug administration. So this may also be an alternative for drug delivery when looking for use in an acute situation. Lastly, I want to briefly discuss nasal drug administration. Nasal cavity has some advantages. It's got an intermediate surface area. It's rich in vasculature and microvilli, and it can be very good at drug absorption. And in fact, there's some evidence that you can realize direct absorption from the nasal sinuses directly into the brain across the cribriform plate. But there are some limitations. The nose is highly sensitive. Getting drug to these paranasal sinuses can be challenging, so you need a device that does this satisfactorily. You also get a lot of turnover in terms of the mucus layer, and there's a ciliary movement that moves drug to the posterior part of the nasal cavity and eventually into the throat. And another major challenge is that you have a very small volume limitation. You can maximally deliver about 200 microliters into the nose. But again, using the right drug, in this case, again, midazolam, you can actually, again, produce a therapeutic effect very rapidly. This was work done by Lahat in an emergency department with kids who had long febrile seizures. The clock started when the physician said, give drug. If you used intranasal midazolam, that was done in 3.5 minutes. It took a little while to draw up and administer the IV formulation of diazepam. And when you ask the question, when did the seizure stop? The intranasal product, intranasal midazolam, actually stopped the seizures more quickly than IV delivery. Two products in the United States have been developed, one for midazolam and one for diazepam. This is an example of the midazolam product, trade name is Nasolam. And you can see that the Tmax, the time to maximum concentration in this pharmacokinetic study was very rapid, under 15 minutes. And you can see that there was a very rapid onset of sleepiness, 15 to 20 minutes after drug delivery. These studies, both with diazepam and midazolam, have resulted in approved products. One is called Nasolam, as I've shown you. The other one is for diazepam called Valtoco. There is an intriguing possibility that by delivering a drug into the nasal cavity, you can get drug directly into the brain through direct nose-to-brain drug delivery. This is some work done about 15 years ago in which a solution of carbamazepine, an anti-seizure drug, was administered intranasally to rats. The top part of this graph shows brain concentrations following nasal delivery, and the bottom part of this shows the curve for plasma. In other words, the nasal delivery resulted in manyfold higher brain concentrations, suggesting direct delivery to the brain. But these approaches depend on the compound, the formulation, and the delivery of the drug to the nasal cavities. And regardless, it's likely that only a fraction, perhaps a small fraction of a dose, is actually absorbed direct to the brain. Now, going through this very quickly, you're not going to be an expert, but now you know some of the questions to ask. And as you move from simple to complex, or as one moves to late stage preclinical studies, that's the time to begin asking, what is the route and formulation I need? It's the time to seek experts, either at your own or other institutions. Increasingly, universities with clinical and translational science awards, NCATS awards, or places with colleges of pharmacy may well have that expertise you need. You can also directly go to NCATS, as they have a very sophisticated set of experts who can help guide you with this. And then lastly, there are a number of contract organizations that can help with formulation, manufacturing, and analytical work that ensures that you get a properly developed drug ready for an IND submission. I hope this has been helpful, and Dr. Donovan and I look forward to your questions in a few minutes. In summary, there is no universal rule. Formulation and route of administration will differ depending on the properties of the drug, its PK, and its indication. Initially, you'll want to try IV and IP, but later the route may require, may be dictated by the clinical studies. For injectable formulations, you need to use what are known as GRAS solvents, as Dr. Donovan explained. You want to avoid solvent concentrations with pharmacological or toxicological activity. And as I've said, get help early within or outside your institution. Well, thank you very much for your attention, and I look for to work with you toward the remainder of this training course.
Okay, terrific. Thanks to Dr. Donovan and Dr. Cloyd for very comprehensive and very clear lectures. We'll now open it up for discussion. Do any of the students have questions? If so, please let us know. While we're waiting for the students, I'm going to ask a question to Dr. Donovan, and certainly Dr. Cloyd can chime in as well. Dr. Donovan, many of our students, I'm expecting, when they complete their discovery process, are going to be ending up with compounds that are not terribly water soluble. And you touched on the idea that in that case, a suspension could be used. And I wonder if you could elaborate a little bit more on how our students should think about creating suspensions. What size particles are required? Are they micronized or nanoparticles? And can you just give us a little bit of information along those lines?
Sure, and a really good question with a lot of caveats to get you to a direct answer. And let me explain a bit. So with a suspension, what we're doing is administering solid drug along with drug in solution, where however we put the solid drug into whatever solvent system we're actually using, be it water, be it some combination of co-solvents and so forth, some drug's gonna go into solution in that, the rest of it's gonna remain as solid. And then we're left with, it depends on where you're going to administer it to determine somewhat what the particle size limits are. So for oral administration, for example, I could have pretty big particles. And in the world of particles in suspension, I'm talking 250 microns in diameter or so. And usually, you know, when we deal with particles, the size is always a distribution. And so I can speak in mean size, but that distribution is probably pretty broad. Compare that to if I'm trying to do a direct ophthalmic topical approach, I can't have particles that are any larger than 10 microns because they're actually physically irritating to the eye. It'll cause excessive tearing and it'll wash out any drug that I applied there far too rapidly. So the particle size becomes a question of where am I going to administer it? So there are similar limitations for intramuscular or subcutaneous, and usually we don't do do suspensions in the subcutaneous space, but it might be worth talking about the rationale for that. Anyway, you know, 10 microns or so, even at those sites, is probably a good guesstimate for size. Now, you talked about nanoparticles. And there, I always have to try to clarify with people, when we talk about nanoparticles, there are nanoparticles that we make out of pure drug crystal that we make. So the nanoparticle itself is just solid drug. And it's just very small size, less than 100 nanometers in size, typically in diameter. And then there's nanoparticles where we've taken the drug and combined it with a polymer, usually some other sort of material or maybe a lipid, and made a particle composition that's less than 100 nanometers, maybe arguably a little bit larger than that. And so the beating up your particle, drug particle, to make it less than 100 nanometers in size helps with what we call dissolution rate, the rate at which it goes into solution. And sometimes that's a significant advantage. You've got to have really dedicated equipment to be able to get particles that are that small reproducibly. That's where, as Dr. Cloyd just talked about, talk to the experts, get tied in with a CRO or some other group that can provide you with that, those materials, because you can't do it just with a lab scale kind of apparatus. If you want to make polymer or lipid associated nanoparticles, that's great. You can do those on a laboratory scale. But I'll tell you that they're complicated. They're complicated to characterize. They're complicated to scale up. And so the rationale for doing that, there are certainly a lot of reasons to do it for targeted delivery. But again, it gets complicated very quickly. And your goals for what you want that those nanoparticles or how you want them to perform need to be identified outside of just they need to work better. Which is what I've heard from lots of people I've talked with. Yep, we need to administer these somehow. So I've kind of wandered off your question, but because there is really no great answer for what particle size or what should my solid characteristics be, because again, it depends on where it is I'm planning on administering this and how much I have to have in the solid fraction.
Great, okay, well, thank you so much. We have a number of questions from students. Our first question is from Ben Colbert. Ben?
Yeah, hopefully this is an easy question, but I was just wondering if there's any websites or any resources available that just kind of list kind of safe in human additives, components that would be involved in formulation, just so that as we're thinking through our development, we can kind of like be like, all right, yep, that's something that has been used, has been approved, et cetera. Do you know of any, or, and maybe someone can put it in the chat or, yep.
Absolutely. The best website for that for US use is fda.gov. And if you go to the FDA website and search for inactive ingredients, or the, what's known as the inactive ingredient guide, I believe. And that's exactly where I got the information that I presented in my talk earlier. Every material that's been approved for a human use in the United States is included in there at the level and at the route of administration it's been approved for. So it's not an exhaustive list, but it's a darn fine place to start. And it narrows down your options pretty quickly for a number of materials if you don't want to go through the extra trouble of the toxicity studies for your excipients. So inactive ingredient database.
Great, okay. Gonzalo, you're next.
Thank you, very nice talk. This is a question more for Dr. Cloyd. On your presentation, you mentioned these depot injections. So how long can these injections keep delivering the drug? And can you get a stable plasma concentrations with a depot injection?
I'm sure Dr. Donovan can also add to this response, but there are
approved products available for one that comes to mind is contraception. These can produce a contraceptive effect for several months or longer, but you need to be careful about volume. We've talked about that. And so the drug needs to be reasonably potent. You can control the release rates. So you can potentially get that stable plasma concentration you were about what you were asking. And the release rates have to be commensurate with the elimination rate. So if your release rate is really slow, but your compound has a very short half-life, you're going to have a problem. So in considering these options, again, as we've been saying, take a look at the physical, chemical, and pharmacokinetic characteristics of your compound, and then look at the possibility that a depot injection might be relevant. As far as the technology, again, you might want to seek out an expert. But Dr. Donovan, do you have any additional comments about this technology?
The only thing to add is I think especially the microparticle depot type injections that are showing up in increasing numbers, 3 to 6 months is probably about the maximum you can expect from those. The solid implants that Dr. Cloyd was referring to, the contraceptive implants, a couple of other therapeutics that have been evaluated, maybe a few years actually of drug release. But again, you have to have an incredibly potent compound to be able to load up a implant that you place hopefully someplace inconspicuously and innocuously and have it have enough drug in it to deliver for the couple of years that you are hoping to have delivery for. So it's possible, extremely long time periods are possible, but it's very compound dependent.
Has it been used in children? Sorry.
Have they? I believe the Microsphere implant systems have been evaluated at least in adolescents, but I'm not sure that there are many pediatric studies because most of the compounds that are currently in the marketplace, at least, wouldn't necessarily be therapeutics that would be used in children. But there are likely no reasons why you couldn't conceive of a pediatric dosage form using this. And it might be extremely convenient and a solution to some issues. So from a biology and developmental standpoint, there's the materials that are used, there shouldn't be any reason why they would be incompatible to deliver to children. But I'm not aware of anything in the commercial market space. Maybe Dr. Cloyd might be aware of something that I'm not. But otherwise, I would suspect there have been some clinical trials, but probably not extensive, just because it's a fragile population. And you have to really have a well-designed and well-understood material and formulation probably before you approach a clinical trial in pediatrics.
Thank you. I have nothing more to add. I'm not familiar with the other products that you were talking about.
Okay, great. Shirley, you have a question for Dr. Cloyd.
Yeah, yes. First, thanks for the great talk. So for Dr. Cloyd, I have a question. Can anybody be delivered with intranasal injection in human and in small animals? And if so, what is the mechanism, such as transporters or just a passive diffusion?
There are reports in the literature of antibodies or large molecules, perhaps better to say, such as enzymes, using protein fusion technology that had been administered into rodents intranasally, and then you can demonstrate that these compounds are in the brain with using technology to identify these compounds. How they get into the brain is less clear to me, but there is evidence that you can attach a large molecule or administer a large molecule such as insulin into the brain cavity, and you will get direct nose to brain drug delivery. If you're going to do this, you've got some limitations, as we've talked about. The volume is a limitation. And if you're depending on direct to brain drug delivery, you need a fairly potent compound because the actual amount of the dose delivered by that route, that is to say nose to brain, is likely small.
Okay, thank you.
I'll just comment that sometimes absorption through the nose can be enhanced with permeation enhancers. There's a large literature on different kinds of excipients that can be added to your active pharmaceutical ingredient to enhance nasal absorption. There's some idea that some of these can break down to the tight junctions that you heard about in one of the other lectures that may prevent diffusion. Next is Run Duo and has a question for Dr. Donovan.
Okay, thanks, Donovan. Good talk. So I just have a question about does formulation such as the nanoparticle have their impact on the selectivity? Which means have the different ratio between tumor and the plasma? And if so, how does it work?
So I'm just a quick clarification. Are you asking a bit about the mechanism for nanoparticle targeted delivery to tumors and how the nanoparticles actually end up being targeted, I think is sort of the crux of the question.
Yes.
And what I'm going to be speaking to is these polymeric nanoparticles that have materials that are both targeting and controlling their distribution. They're typically administered intravenously. They stay as particles. They actually don't dissolve once intravenously injected, or at least for a period of time, they don't dissolve. And what they're doing is they're acting like particles act, and the body is responding to them as particles. And so they're getting, depending on the materials being used, they're being engulfed by the reticular endothelial system cells, which are programmed to take up particulate matter that's in our bodies, that's essentially foreign. In the case of tumor targeting, because the tumor vasculature is compromised, we don't have tight junctions between the endothelial cells that are keeping materials from leaking through the capillary beds inside the tumor. And as a result, just essentially because of pressure flow, that when a nanoparticle is flowing through a tumor in that compromised vascular bed, it has easy access to be able to move out into those tissues. Now, what it doesn't have is the ability to move back into the circulatory system. So basically, it's just physically trapped because as particles, they don't go back in. So they're essentially being filtered out in the tumor, which allows them to accumulate at higher concentrations. And they accumulate in the liver and they accumulate somewhat in the lungs and so forth, the typical tissues where we see particle uptake happening as part of biological function.
Thank you so much.
Okay, I think we're going to cut it there. But for those of you who have asked questions that we weren't able to get to, we will continue with the questions during the office hours at the end of the day. So please join the office hours if we weren't able to get your questions answered now. So we are going to move on to the next lecture, and this is on toxicology. The faculty member is Dr. Adeline Smith.
My name is Adeline Smith, and I am going to talk about non-clinical safety assessment, and it's all about dose. The general outline for my talk is I'll give an overview of toxicology and drug development, the other name for non-clinical safety assessment. I'll give a definition, the relevance of the studies that are conducted, and what the overall objectives are. The second part of this talk will be focused on the types of studies that you'll conduct during drug development. They're investigative tox studies that you conduct during drug discovery. There's studies to support first in human clinical trials and an investigational new drug application here in the US. And then there's studies supporting clinical development and the new drug application. first thing I need to do is introduce this gentleman, Paracelsus, who was lived in the 16th century and is considered to be the father of toxicology. And his famous quote, he was a physician, an alchemist, and an astrologer, which at the time was not necessarily a disconnect. They were all very closely related as disciplines. But his famous quote was, all substances are poison. There is none which is not a poison. And the right dose differentiates poison from remedy. He was really the first person to describe a dose response and the continuum from a safe concentration or dose and a toxic concentration or dose. So for drug development, let's define what toxicology is. It's the study of adverse effects produced by a potential therapeutic in an appropriate model. And the appropriate model can be in silico, it can be in vitro, it can be ex vivo, and it can be in vivo in animals and in vivo in humans. Why are toxicology studies important for drug development? Because there's a scientific need to understand the toxicity and therefore the safety of drugs. First, do no harm. And we use animals as surrogates to understand toxicity and inform toxicity in humans as well. And toxicology studies, or the regulations associated with toxicology studies, were historically related to the patent medicines, which were very popular during the 1800s and early 1900s. Here is an example of Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup, which was a patent medicine that was marketed to young mothers to use with their children were teething. And because there was morphine in the syrup, a lot of infants died because of morphine overdoses. And this and several other examples of tragic consequences of patent medicines really initiated the first 1906 Food and Drug Act for misbranding. In 1938, cosmetics were added, and the safety of compounds was required. In 1962, efficacy was required, and then in 1997, the Food and Drug Administration Modernization Act was put into place. Pharmaceuticals toxicity, both human and animal, are responsible for the termination of about 30% of drugs in development. This is a very high percentage. And you can't just simply lower the dose because you have to maximize your efficacy. So if animals are used to evaluate safety, how does animal toxicity relate to human toxicity for pharmaceuticals? First, I need to point out that there are basic differences in the way studies are done in animals and in humans. In animals, they're usually large groups of animals, both male and female. They're usually healthy and relatively young, sexually mature but young. There's a homogeneous genetic background, uniform environment, all light, dark cycles are scheduled. Food is monitored and qualified. And there's a uniform environment that the studies are conducted. And then you're defining the toxicity of a compound. In humans, you're looking at individual responses. The humans are usually sick and it's all ages. It's a heterogeneous genetic background and quite a variable environment because of different nutritional status and all of that is not controlled. And you're usually describing toxicity and not really defining it. as well, you've got differences between animals and humans in the compound and the way the bodies handle the compound. There can be differences in pharmacology, metabolism, distribution, pharmacokinetics, as well as biological response. So there have been numerous evaluations of toxicity data collected in animals and how that data is relevant to humans. A couple that I'm going to point out, which I'm including the references for, the first two are retrospective analysis, and they were really evaluating severe toxicity, clinical toxicity, and looking back at the animal data. And the animal data is relatively concordant, meaning that the toxicity, the severe or high, very high incidence toxicity was observed or concordant with the animal data that had been collected. A prospective analysis was done relatively recently to determine prospectively how non-clinical safety assessments in animal models translate to a phase one clinical risk, meaning your first in human clinical risk. When you looked at the sensitivity, which was positive clinical findings that had positive non-clinical findings, the sensitivity was only 48%. What was striking was the specificity, meaning negative clinical findings that had negative non-clinical findings, was very high, 84%. So the overall conclusion of this study was that the absence of toxicity in animal studies strongly predicts a similar outcome in the first in human trial. So toxicology studies are important for drug development because there's a scientific need and a regulatory requirement to understand toxicity and the safety of drugs. Safety concerns based on animal and human toxicities are responsible for termination of a large percentage of drugs during development, and animal toxicity evaluations are useful in estimating safe doses in humans. So when are toxicology studies conducted during drug development? They're actually conducted early in discovery all the way through preclinical and clinical drug development. So this whole part of the paradigm of drug development, toxicology studies are being conducted. While this graph is up, I'm going to use it to define the two regulatory milestones again. So you got your investigational new drug, which you collect data and present it to the regulatory authorities and get approval to move into humans and clinical trials. And then you've got the new drug application, which is another big data submission to the regulatory authorities so that you can actually market your compound. There are two other words I'd like to define. I use the term candidate selection. After discovery, after you've done a lot of screening, you're selecting one or two candidates to move into preclinical development. And the other is your clinical candidate. So after preclinical development, you select a compound to move into clinical trials. So for toxicology studies, the overall objectives are to identify a toxicity profile. There's a dose response relationship. You want to define it from safe to adverse, and you want to identify potential safety risks. But I always feel like I need to say you need to define a safe dose, but it's really a false notion that drugs must be safe. It's really the dose of the drug that needs to be safe. And so it's all about the dose, and therefore toxicity and safety is dependent on dose and exposure. So you're balancing your safe and efficacious or your benefit and risk, and you're defining a safety window. A good example of a dose response is that people might be familiar with is orally administered alcohol. The acute toxicity of alcohol is represented by this dose response curve. This is the dose, or you can say blood alcohol, and this is your response. So after one or two drinks, you might have a blood alcohol level of 0.05%. And it's, this says giddy, but it's really a stimulant and a social relaxation that occurs. And you could probably term this as being the desired result of drinking alcohol. However, as you go up on the dose response curve, when you get to 0.08 to 0.1% blood alcohol levels, your speech is slurred. You usually become very uncoordinated. You shouldn't drive, and you're legally drunk. And moving up even further, you get to 0.3% blood alcohol, and the CNS depression continues, and you become, you fall asleep and can become unconscious. And due to respiratory failure at 0.4 and above, death occurs. So the acute toxicity of alcohol is related to CNS toxicity. Chronic toxicity of alcohol is actually hepatic toxicity and cirrhosis of the liver. And there's also toxicity associated with pregnant women who drink alcohol and effects on the developing fetuses. It's called fetal alcohol syndrome. Here's another example of a dose response. This is the effect on blood pressure, which is a very well-behaved dose response. So you see an efficacy response associated with a certain dose or concentrations, and then you see a toxicity response. So the safety window is the difference between the dose, and I mean exposure and or concentration, between the desired therapeutic effect and the undesired toxicity or side effect. I'm going to define another word. It's the NOAEL, which is no observed adverse effect level, and is often used to calculate the safety window, meaning the dose that does not produce any toxicity at all. And it's the highest no observed adverse effect level. So the ratio of the NOAEL exposure and the efficacy exposure is defined as your safety window. A couple of things I need to mention. Toxicity may be due to pharmacologic effects, meaning an exaggerated response or response in the wrong tissue. For instance, if you have a drug that is for constipation and you give it to patients and they get an exaggerated response such as diarrhea, it potentially is related to the pharmacologic effects of the compound, and it's not always considered to be adverse. Off-target effects are usually considered to be adverse and not associated with the intended pharmacology of the compound. Let's talk a little bit about the types of studies of types of toxicology studies for non-clinical safety assessment. You've got investigative toxicology studies, which are conducted during drug discovery. You've got studies supporting your first in human clinical trials, the investigational new drug application, and you've got studies supporting clinical development as well as your new drug application. And so investigative toxicology studies during drug discovery are conducted usually after compounds and compound series are identified, and they're focused on selecting one or a small number of candidate molecules to take into preclinical development. So why conduct investigative toxicity studies during drug discovery when you have to conduct a whole lot of studies in preparation for clinical studies? But these are really important because they're the preliminary safety assessment of compounds and compound series, and you can identify and mitigate potential toxicity risks before you select a candidate to move forward into preclinical development. The other is that they're non-regulated studies. So they're usually small studies. They're usually in silico and in vitro studies. They don't require a lot of compound, and they are really informing the chemistry associated with a certain target, et cetera, and trying to identify potential toxicity risks of compounds and compound series. There are a number of things that you should consider evaluating during investigative toxicity studies. Again, a lot of them are physical chemical properties. You'll have selectivity screens to understand how well your compound hits the target that you're interested in. You might have some in vitro mechanistic or cytotoxicity studies. And then you might want to consider doing some toxicity screening. Cardiovascular, liver, and genetic toxicity are a high liability for drug development. And a lot of times you'll want to at least have a preliminary peek at what potential toxicity risks there might be. And then you'll do in vivo some in vivo studies to get ready for your next series of evaluations. For CNS therapeutics, there are a lot of special things that need to be considered. There's exaggerated or unanticipated pharmacology because the compounds cross the blood-brain barrier. They might produce desired CNS effects, but also undesired CNS effects. You need to be able to monitor and quantitate your toxicities, and doing studies in animals may not be as relevant to humans. There are certain toxicities, for instance, nausea and headaches. There are a lot of species differences in brain function and physiology that are important to consider when you're selecting animal species. Safety windows can be narrow, and therefore the estimate of the safety window is critical to understand. And there is a special consideration called abuse liability potential that has to be considered for any drug that's distributed to the brain or produces CNS activity. So you're done with discovery and you've selected a candidate or two, and you're moving into preclinical development with a focus on an investigational new drug application. So the application that all of this data will inform. I have to mention good laboratory practice. This is special regulations that were put into place to it relates to a quality system of management controls, and it's to ensure uniformity, consistency, reliability, reproducibility, quality, and integrity of non-clinical toxicology studies. And they were passed in 1976 due to widespread deficiencies in design and conduct. Their poor laboratory conduct and actually due to a widespread investigation, there were criminal charges that were brought against some organizations that were not well documenting and conducting toxicology studies. GLP is an international standard, Europe, US, and as well as Japan. And GLP toxicology study, GLP is required for any toxicology studies intended to support research or marketing applications. You say, well, I keep a good notebook. I've got good laboratory practice, and my laboratory is kept very organized and clean. But this is a different level of good laboratory practice. There's both good scientific practices as well as a GLP administrative structure. So you've got standard operating procedures. You've got you need adequate facilities, qualified and properly maintained instrumentation, as well as a written protocol, an identified study director, GLP compliance statements, and QA oversight. So in addition, their ICH guidelines, which is the International Conference of Harmonization of Technical Requirements, that covers all aspects of pharmaceutical drug development. We're going to be focused on the safety And these guidances are types and timing of design of non-clinical studies that support research in humans and marketing applications. The questions you need to ask before getting started with your GLP toxicology studies, you need to evaluate what the plans for clinical assessment are, your animal models, drug substance and formulation, as well as your bioanalytical toxicokinetic support. The types of studies conducted during drug development are genetic toxicity studies guided by ICHS2, safety pharmacology studies, and general tox studies. The ICH guidelines are identified. And I always like to remind everybody about the three R's to replace, reduce, and refine animal use in toxicology studies. There are also a lot of other guidances that are of interest. The S6 in particular is biotechnology derived pharmaceuticals. Anti-cancer pharmaceuticals is S9. And then there are lots of guidance documents from regional authorities. Special considerations for large molecules and biologics guided by ICHS9 is the assessment of the relevance of the animal model is particularly important. And then the tissue cross-reactivity evaluation for both on and off target binding, as well as immunogenicity. So toxicology studies are conducted more frequently on a case-by-case basis with large molecules and biologics. So let's talk about the GLP toxicology studies to support first-in-human clinical trials and your IND application. Evaluating the toxicity in animals is to inform the relative risk to humans and identify a safe dose. The first set of toxicology studies are genetic tox studies, which are a surrogate for carcinogenicity, and you evaluate the potential effects on genetic material. It includes both in vitro and in vivo assays. You usually conduct screening studies in discovery or during investigation, but these are GLP studies and so are more comprehensive. There are a couple of options. The Ames assay is a particular robust assay used frequently, and then there are in vitro mammalian cell assays as well, or you can take the option of conducting an in vivo assay along with the Ames assay to support your first in human study. Like I said, the Ames assay is a bacterial reverse mutation assay done in multiple strains. There's a variety of in vitro assays, and your in vivo assessment is usually done in rodents with one or two endpoints to measure chromosomal damage. Safety pharmacology studies where the evaluation of potential of drug-related adverse effects on the physiological function of major organs. Usually you do central nervous system, pulmonary, and cardiovascular assessments, but it can also be incorporated into repeat dose toxicity studies. DNS function assessments are frequently evaluated in rodents, and as are your pulmonary functional assessments. I feel a particular need to mention the cardiovascular safety pharmacology. You do an in vitro HERG assay, which is a potassium ion channel, that about 50 compounds were removed from market because of their effects on the HERG channel, preventing the outflow of potassium ions and cardiac repolarization. So the increase in repolarization time and an increase in the QT interval can lead to ventricular fibrillation. So it's good to evaluate the effect and a regulatory requirement to evaluate the potential effect on the HERG channel. You also conduct an in vivo telemetry study, usually in a non-rodents, and it's usually physiologically relevant and integrated system where you're collecting continuous data. There are other isolated ion channels that are worth considering, as well as pluripotent cardiomyocyte that can inform the proarrhythmic risk assessment for humans. Your general tox studies are to evaluate the toxicity profile, the dose and exposure relationship, and identify safe doses. These are in vivo studies, and two species are usually evaluated. The schedule and the route are the same as the proposed clinical schedule, so you really have to understand what your clinical schedule is. You usually incorporate multiple dose levels to evaluate a dose response. Your exposure is evaluated and recovery groups are included. Your endpoints are clinical observation, body weights, food consumption, plasma exposure, toxicokinetics. You might have pharmacodynamic and biomarkers, as well as clinical pathology, hematology, clinical chemistry, coagulation, and urinalysis. And at necropsy, you'll collect organ weights, macroscopic observations, as well as histopathology. Hopefully, a dose response and a toxicity profile is assessed. You evaluate exposure, whether or not there are gender differences, what your steady state exposure looks like, and relationship to toxicity. You determine a no observed adverse effect level used to calculate a safe first in human starting dose, and you estimate a safety window, as well as use for dose setting for future toxicology studies. So you've gone through discovery, all your screening tox activities, here, and you've got a whole bunch of medicinal chemistry, pharmacology, and PK going on. You've selected your candidate and moved into GLP studies and collected a lot of GLP data, and you're up to your investigational new drug application to initiate human studies, and you celebrate. Big milestone. So now you're in clinical studies and you're supporting clinical development with your non-clinical tox studies. And you're looking towards a new drug application, which is the application for marketing. So there's several, and I'll go through these relatively quickly. There's several types of studies that you're conducting during clinical development. You conduct subchronic and chronic toxicity studies depending upon the schedule. The need for and in design of the study is dependent not only on the therapeutic indication, but the target patient population, as well as clinical development and commercial plans. There are a series of reproductive and developmental toxicity studies, which are especially important because the data from these studies are included in the label after approval surrogate data for human risk. Carcinogenicity studies and a weight of evidence evaluation to define the best approach, as well as there are a lot of other studies which I've listed here. So you've gone through clinical development phase 2 and phase 3, and you've gone through a lot of GLP toxicology studies during clinical development, and you take both that clinical data and that preclinical data, and there you submit it for a new drug application. And when that is approved, you really celebrate because that's quite a milestone. And only about 10% of drugs get to a new drug application and to market. So to summarize, non-clinical safety assessment is critical for drug development. There's a scientific need and a regulatory requirement to collect information to define the toxicity profile and provide an evaluation of the relationship of dose and exposure to toxicity and safety in animals, which is used to inform safe clinical development and marketing of drugs. The results from these studies are used to inform human risk. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Adeline, for that excellent and very informative presentation on what can be, you did it very clearly on what could be a complex process. So open it up now for questions. Are there any questions for Adeline from the students? If not, I'll get us started on the first question. So many students in the course are identifying new chemical entities or lead compounds that they're interested in moving forward. So in that situation, what do you think is the most critical sort of in vitro screens and then in vivo screens that one could do to rule out the, or not rule out, but the kind of de-risk the toxicology potential of the compound?
That's always a great question, and I'll talk about it being very project dependent, what you decide to use as your tox screen. But I think that there is probably always the importance of a selectivity screen is always very high on the list, as well as thinking about what types of in silico and in vitro assays can help you in de-risk tox issues downstream. The hERG has been mentioned quite a lot. It's a relatively straightforward in vitro assay. They've got screening paradigms, so you can actually do a lot of screening of different compounds. And that's a good way to de-risk, doesn't require a lot of material and is relatively inexpensive. As well as probably a gene tox screen. Again, you can do an Ames assay in a screening mode. You can do a number of compounds from different compound series and collect important information to de-risk the potential of interactions with DNA. Of course, those are both probably focused more on small molecules than they would be on large molecules. On large molecules, you've got different kinds of selectivity screening, as well as potential immunogenicity and other questions that you might be asking.
Okay, so for someone with a small molecule, the in vitro things you want to do is hERG, Ames, and a selectivity screen. Those are the, you're thinking.
Probably would be on the top of my list, regardless of the project. But there's always additional questions that you might have related to toxicity, depending upon the program and the indication.
Sure, makes sense. Well, we got a lot of questions coming in, Adeline. So let me look. Eric Garcia has a question related to drug-drug interactions. Eric?
Thank you for the talk. It was wonderful. And I was beginning to wonder for diseases and disorders that have kind of a trajectory, I'm thinking like substance use disorders where somebody might be prescribed methadone or prescribed like naltrexone at different phases of their recovery. If you're developing some type of adjunct or maybe even a standalone medication, do you have to show like a non-drug-drug interaction with all of those different types of medications that a person could be prescribed during their recovery process?
So that actually is a complex question, and this is the overlap between your ADME and your tox. There are regulations that about drug-drug interactions and how to approach them. They've got in vitro approaches to understand how your compound interacts with a variety of the CYP enzymes, et cetera. From a tox perspective, you're usually not evaluating the combinations unless you plan on administering it as a combination. So let's say you've got a new drug that you're going to be administering with another drug in your first clinical trial. In that case, you may want to evaluate the new drug, and then you do the combination to see if there are effects. So you're really thinking about two different things. A lot of times in your first clinical trials, you will probably exclude certain people based upon background medications, et cetera. So it's really not a very easy question to answer in a general kind of way. Yes, drug-drug interactions are very important. They usually don't affect tox studies unless you're planning on administering combinations. Does that make sense?
No, that makes perfect sense. That's what I was trying to wonder was when you have an adjunct that you're trying to develop, if you were going to plan on testing it in the preclinical with, like a buprenorphine or something. So that makes perfect sense. Thank you.
So let me just make sure, if you're planning in your clinical trial to administer the compounds together, you will likely need to evaluate whether or not you see a potentiation of toxicity or a change in the tox profile preclinically.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, Adeline, there's quite a number of questions coming through, but given the time, I'm going to take two more questions. And for those that we don't have time to get to, I just want to remind you that we have office hours, and Adeline will be at the office hours this afternoon that can ask the questions that we don't have time to get to. So Philomena, do you want to ask your question?
Yes. So you mentioned how, of course, mouse models or rodents might be different from humans. And so for toxicity studies, especially for CNS, this might be relevant since the development of the brain is completely different. Is there any other animal model that is preferred for these kind of studies? And then the follow-up question is, the side effects such as nausea, headache, those are very common. And I think everybody has seen them in pretty much all the common drugs, even the off-the-counter drugs that you can just get. Are those evaluated only in the phase one and two of the clinical trials then?
So can I ask you to repeat the first part of your question?
Yes, so is there a different animal model that it's preferred for CNS drugs for toxicity studies other than rodents? I'm guessing monkeys.
So you're required, I'm sorry, I was just making sure I heard the question. You're required as part of your GLP studies to do a rodent and a non-rodent. So do mice or rats. Rats are usually preferred for tox studies for a variety of historical kinds of reasons. And for your non-rodents, you usually use a dog or monkeys. For CNS therapeutics, you usually do some pharmacology kinds of studies and or PK studies in monkeys, even if you're not using them for tox, because they frequently will give you additional information about brain penetration and, you know, those kinds of things. So, and your second question?
Was like side effects that are very common, but very human specific, like headache and nausea. Yes, are those evaluated only?
And that's why I was pointing that out, that sometimes your animal models are not going to be useful in predicting, especially for CNS therapeutics, sometimes predicting a side effect profile.
Thank you.
All right, I will take one more question from Marissa before we go into the break.
Yes.
Hi, Marissa.
You can hear me, okay? Yes? Okay.
Yes.
So my question is, what about repurposing a drug that has been approved by FDA? If I want to use a drug administration, do I need to go to all those GLP studies again, or?
I tried to mention when we were talking, I don't remember which day, maybe Monday or something, about repurposing drugs. A lot of time they have safety data already, and that they're used in humans already. And I think your particular case are both compounds that are used in human. So it really depends upon how you're approaching your clinical development and how large the amount of data that you can use to support that clinical development plan, whether or not you need to do additional studies. Does that make sense?
Okay. Yes, thank you.
All right. Thank you to Adeline and all of the morning speakers for great talks. We're now going to go into our break for those, depending on where you live, this is either a breakfast break or a lunch break. And we'll come back here at 1:10 Eastern time to resume with a talk from Ted Spack, who's going to talk about IND enabling studies. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, welcome back, everybody. That was a pretty short break, but we're ready to get back into it. It's a real pleasure for me today to introduce our next speaker, Ted Spack from MetaRed, who's going to be discussing today a very, very critical component in going from bench to bedside. It's the IND. And so the title of his talk today is IND Enabling Studies and Preparation of the IND.
Good morning and good afternoon. Welcome to session 11, IND Enabling Studies and Preparation of the IND, the Investigational New Drug Application. My name is Ted Spack. My background is in biotech and is typically atypical. I've gotten my PhD and postdoctoral training at Johns Hopkins and Stanford University. And after that, have spent 30 years in the San Francisco Bay Area in biotech, working with a series of biotech startup companies. And most recently, I've co-founded Therini Bio Incorporated, which is focused on developing monoclonal antibodies for neuroinflammation. I became a consultant to run an innovative scouting program for the National MS Society, and currently consulting on both preclinical development and entrepreneurship, working on projects including MS, AD, PD, pain, and in vitro models of brain and BBB. So some of you are perhaps thinking, my focus is on discovering drugs. Why should I worry about preclinical development? In other words, once the rockets go up, who cares where they come down? That's really not my department. What I hope to convince you today is that understanding the whole process is really important, because drug development is not a violin solo. It's not a series of discrete steps. It's actually a continuum that involves, like a relay race, a lot of handoffs. And those handoffs are where a lot of slips can occur. Bad drug candidates can fail for good reasons, but unfortunately, sometimes good drug candidates fail for bad reasons. So I think if you understand the overview and the process, you have a better chance that your great discovery will make it to the finish line. The other reasons why you might care is there are jobs in this area, jobs that draw on all your scientific training that tax you to think strategically as well as tactically. And finally, if you're going to do any kind of grant applications that involve development and translation, having an understanding of the process can be an advantage. So with that in mind, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about both strategy and tactics in this talk. I'm not going to turn you into regulatory experts in 30 minutes. That usually takes at least 45 minutes, actually many years longer. But what I do want you to do is to think a little bit about both strategy and tactics to develop an effective plan. So with that in mind, I'm going to have to drag out again the chart that we have burned into our retinas. the whole attrition process of drug development. And as you can see, that process is a continuum. There's no sharp demarcation line where discovery ends and development begins. But there are a couple of discrete boundaries and markers. And one is the boundary between preclinical and clinical. And that boundary is marked by the IND application shown in our first triangle. Now, beginning with the end in mind means we also have to be thinking about that second triangle, the NDA, the new drug application, or the biological license application. It comes at the end, and that is the FDA approval point for actually marketing and applying a new drug. That's a process of attrition, as you can see here. And non-clinical studies, I want to point out, don't end with an IND. I'll be talking about preclinical studies, but as I'll show you in the talk section, there are other studies that continue into the human part of the process. The other thing I want to point out is that important X-axis, that this takes time, and time burns patent life. So there's a real premium on working coordinately here and working with other groups involved in this process so you don't burn too much patent life. I inherited a really good CIRM for breast cancer at one point in my career. That unfortunately had used up so much time in its preclinical development phase that no company would pick it up. They couldn't recoup their costs in the remaining development and clinical testing time. So there's a real premium on time in this process. The next slide here shows one of the most famous maps in cartography. It is Charles Monnard's map of Napoleon's invasion of Russia and retreat from Moscow. And its resemblance to the drug discovery and development process is not necessarily not coincidental. What it does remind us is we really have to begin with the end in mind, and we have to practice project management and a process that I like to refer to as preventative worrying, that is anticipating where the problems are and coming up with solutions before the train wreck. So understanding the process, I think, can help you with that and make sure that you never invade Moscow in the winter. So the drug development process is full of three-letter acronyms, and it's quite a confusing sea to navigate. I'll try to define some of these as we go. But as we navigate this process, we use a lot of four-letter words. But the one that we have to keep an eye on the most is the four-letter word risk. Risk is inherent in this process, and one of the things we need to do as we're developing a new drug discovery is to de-risk this as quickly and efficiently as possible. The way we do that is to keep track of this process and understand the multiple pathways that are involved in it and the handoffs that are involved. And so this is a generic Gantt chart that shows you the development pathway for biologic. And there is a risk in showing a chart like this because each pathway for each drug is a little bit different. But the point I want to make with this is that each of these drug development pathways, whether it's for biologic, whether it's for a small molecule, whether it's for stem cell therapy, they all have multiple handoffs. They all involve multiple types of activities. And many of these activities have to occur in parallel. And many of them have dependencies. That is, certain activities can't occur until other activities take place and are completed. So working in parallel with various groups is important. And again, as I said, time is a critical factor. If you are too risk averse and do this too slowly, then you're going to burn up a lot of patent life. If you're too aggressive and take too many chances, you may end up either repeating steps or having a poor drug candidate going forward. So balancing risk is important. And so what I'd like to spend a few minutes on is talking to you about a way of thinking about this that I heard a number of years ago at the JP Morgan conference for drug licensing. And it was a talk given by Ed Saltzman, who is the founder of Defined Health. A lot of us are used to thinking about the term proof of concept. What Ed stressed was a concept called proof of relevance. And what proof of relevance preaches and reminds us is it's important to balance both commercial risk and scientific risk as we're working through preclinical development and through clinical development stages. And it puts a premium on trying to de-risk your drug candidate at the earliest possible stages. And you can do that in a number of different ways. It's important, as I said, to begin with the end in mind and to think about your clinical relevance. Are there other competing drug candidates out there, either existing and approved or in the pipeline? And this can really be different for different therapeutic indications. In Alzheimer's drug development, there aren't a lot of approved drugs, but there is a lot of development in the pipeline, and it's important to understand what's succeeded and what's failed. In multiple sclerosis, there's over a dozen drugs that are approved for relapsing remitting MS, at very few for progressive. So what you face in competition and what you know about past failures can really help you in development. Intellectual property. Do you have coverage? How much time is left? Can you get coverage for composition of matter as well as use patents? Clinical indicators. Are there biomarkers that can speed your trial? Patient populations. Is your population heterogeneous? Is there a particular age that you want to focus on? Are there patient subpopulations that give you better proof of relevance? Are there perhaps orphan indications that are better to go after first? How are you using animal models? Are they truly predictive of success? Can you use them to validate certain pathways or biomarkers? And finally, translatability. Are you scalable? Can you make enough of this? Is your therapeutic window sufficiently wide? Can you deliver to the target, and can you administer chronically, which is something we often have to do in the development of neurotherapeutic drugs. So with all that as preamble, let's talk a little bit about the regulatory requirements. The regulatory requirements are encoded in the US in 21 CFR 3112, that is the Code of Federal Regulations. That governs drugs for humans, and the part that we're going to focus on today is Part 3112, or 312, Investigational New Drugs. So that's our Bible in the US. A note about laws versus regulations versus guidances. The Food and Drug Administration, the Drug and Cosmetic Act was put in place by Congress in the 1930s and has been amended a number of times since then. It authorizes the FDA to be the authority on drug development and drug approvals, which they do through, as I said, Title 21 CFR. These regulations are enforceable by law. Below that are a series of guidances that are presented by the FDA to guide industry and investigators in their thinking. It represents the current thinking of the FDA. It is not enforceable by law. By analogy, a recommendation or a strong suggestion. You're well advised to follow these. They're good advice for developing your drugs. There are different divisions that are responsible for different types of therapeutics. Some of this is intuitive. Some of it is historical and maybe a little surprising. So the two that we're most interested in today are CBER and CDER. CBER, the Center for Biological Evaluations and Research, governs blood products, biologics, vaccines, tissues, cell and gene therapies. CDER, the Center for Drug Evaluation and Research, not surprisingly, governs small molecules, organic chemicals. But somewhat surprisingly, it's also responsible for monoclonal antibodies, peptides and proteins, and oligonucleotides. For medical devices and radiation, there's the Center of Devices and Radiological Health responsible for those areas. So let's talk a little bit about what requires an IND and what doesn't. The next couple of slides will be a little text heavy. Let me try to guide you through it. An investigational drug is, an IND rather, is required if the research involves a drug, which is defined as articles intended for use in diagnosis, cures, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease. The research is a clinical investigation as defined by 21 CFR 3112.3. So let's talk a little bit about what constitutes a clinical investigation. First, the types of INDs. What we'll be mostly focused on here is investigator INDs. These are studies of unapproved drugs or an unapproved product or in an indication or a new patient population. You may have heard recently about emergency use INDs. Those authorize the use of an experimental drug in an emergency situation that does not allow time for an IND submission. COVID vaccines have been talked about quite recently as emergency use IND. There are also treatment INDs that involve experimental drugs showing promise in clinical testing for immediately life-threatening conditions while the final clinical work is being conducted. We'll mostly focus on what it takes to get an IND approval for a phase one IND, but you should also know that there is an exploratory, sometimes referred to as a phase one clinical trial, that requires a somewhat abbreviated IND. Those are trials that occasionally can be used to look at PK/PD studies. They require much lower doses of a drug than are thought to present a safety risk or certainly efficacy. Industry will occasionally use that for PK/PD studies and others, or delivery questions, but oftentimes they're avoided because it just adds to the development pipeline. So again, we're going to be talking mostly about an investigator IND. When are these not required? They're not required if the drug is lawfully marketed in the US and the investigation is not intended to be reported to the FDA, is not intended to support a change in advertising, doesn't require or involve a new route of administration, a new dose, a new patient population, or other factor that significantly increases risk. And there's that four-letter word again. It's conducted in compliance with an IRB or informed consent requirements, and is not intended to promote or commercialize a new drug, the drug product. So what are examples of this? Minor variations of dosage form, such as a change in capsule for blinding, don't require a new IND. If a healthcare provider, your doctor, wants to prescribe a marketed drug to treat a patient for an unlabeled indication, so in other words, off-label use, that does not require that he submit a new IND. However, commercial companies, pharmaceutical companies, are not allowed to push off-label use. And if the purpose of a study is to evaluate the drug's ability to treat a new disease or condition, that's considered a clinical investigation and an IND is required. So when in doubt, ask your regulatory consultant for the IND or the FDA. Non-exempt requirements, and you'll notice the four-letter word again popping up. Change in a route of administration that increases risk requires an IND. A change in dosing that increases the risk, whether it's a change in the dose amount, frequency, or duration, requires a new IND. A change in a patient population that increases risk. For instance, changing from an oncology population to a chronic elderly neurological population, or changing to a pediatric population from an elderly or middle-aged population. Those would require new INDs. Basically, particularly for a phase one clinical trial, what the IND seeks to reassure the FDA is that you're going to minimize, to the extent possible, serious adverse events. Again, another three-letter acronym, SAE. The way I like to think about this is you're trying to avoid three different four-letter words. You're trying to make sure that your drug is sane, same, and safe. That is, it has a rational investigational plan, it's a defined material, and it's safe in relevant species. The organization of the IND application reflects this same, safe, and sane. So much of this requires an investigator's brochure, which outlines the background of this. This is where all your discovery studies, your animal models are summarized. There's a general investigational plan. There's a study protocol, investigator qualifications, and there's also down below any previous human experience or additional information. In addition, there's the same focus, the chemistry, manufacturing, and control data, the so-called CMC section. And there's also a section on pharmacology and toxicology data, the SAFE section. So I'll be focusing primarily on these sections 7 and 8 in the rest of this talk. Now, I've talked to you about the FDA and the 21 CFR Bible. There is another Bible out there. That is the ICH, the International Council for Harmonization of Technical Requirements for Pharmaceutical Human Use. You know it's international because they spell harmonization with an S instead of a Z. But this is an attempt that was set up a number of years ago to take the regulatory requirements around the world and to make them consistent. And so if you're going to go into clinical studies anywhere but the US, you want to make sure you're complying with this. And the compliance sections really are very similar to what's in the FDA section. I've shown you their organization pyramid on the right here. They also have guidances indicated by these S, S4, S6, X8 are a couple of the ones that are relevant to what we'll be talking about. So know that that's an important Bible as well. Why should you follow these rules? Well, if you don't, the regulatory agencies can bring you to a very difficult and time-consuming stop. And some of the reasons that they'll put you on clinical hold is that you fail to comply with the same SAFE and same regulations. The agency will provide you a letter within 30 days of you submitting your IND application detailing the deficiencies, or if they see deficiencies while the clinical study is in progress. You must address these in writing. They can be quite challenging to complete. So some examples, again, a clinical investigation brochure is, the clinical investigator's unqualified, the brochure is misleading, there's too many insufficient information to assess risk. In other cases, there are issues with quality or toxicology studies or the design. So you want to avoid this. So let's take a few minutes to talk about some of the similarities and differences between small molecules and biologics. In both cases, you're trying to transition from many candidates to a single lead that you're taking into clinical studies. The species activity in some cases may be broad, in other cases may be quite limited, and that can affect the sorts of tox studies you do. With small molecules, you're generally doing synthetic study. With biologics, it's generally cell-based. Your toxicology studies have a lot of similarities, but you may have to pick your species depending upon the efficacy in different animal species. Your assays for looking for tracking the amount of substance in the blood or the brain or other target organs are going to vary whether it's a small molecule or biologic. You may be using HPLC or mass spec versus ELISAs or FACS. Off-tox effects are always important, but particularly can be challenging in small molecules. Whereas in biologics, you have to pay particular attention to immunogenicity. Rate-limiting steps in small molecules often involve the tox studies, whereas in biologics, the manufacturing process can be particularly challenging. So let's talk very quickly about the same part of this. Again, that is particularly emphasizing the investigator brochure. That has elements of the CMC and the tox that you've done. It's a description of the tox substance, formulation, and structure of formula. It includes a summary of the pharmacological and toxicological effects, PK, and what happens to your drug. Potential risks and side effects are all summarized here. And then, of course, the qualifications for your clinical investigations and the site that are conducting this. So let's spend a few minutes on Section 7 of the IND, CMC, chemistry, manufacturing, and control, getting the same. And the idea here is to make sure that you can make each batch of your new chemical entity consistently the same within release specifications. If you're thinking that the animal on the left is the one that's different because he's taller, you may have a future in management. Let me talk briefly about the thinking and the strategy in your transition of your small molecule to a clinical candidate. During the discovery phase, you're probably maximizing the number of candidates you look at through SAR, but in the end, you really need to focus down on a single candidate and understand its salt form and define polymorphs. Purity becomes very important. you want to get to greater than 98% purity if possible, because you must report impurities that are greater than 0.05%. And if your impurities are greater than 0.1%, you have to do separate talks on that. Stability needs to be characterized. You're going to need to scale up from milligrams to likely kilograms. And so there's a real pressure to minimize the number of synthetic steps and maximize yield. And in the end, you need to come up with standard operating procedures for good laboratory practice, GLP, and a certificate of analysis, COA. Where that's important is you're going to need to release lots of these chemicals, and you need to define the lot release specifications tightly enough to satisfy the FDA, but not so tight that you're going to disqualify three out of every four lots. Here's a Gantt chart, just generic, of your development process, again emphasizing that there are parallel processes and dependencies, and to point out that your new chemical entity is defined as a drug substance, but you're going to likely be doing some sort of formulation which requires pre-formulation work, stability work, that defines what's termed the drug product. And in the end, you'll do your scale up and come up with first a GLP batch and finally a GMP batch, a good manufacturing process batch that you take into the clinic. With the biologics candidate, again, some of the similar considerations, but some that are specific to biologics. You may be dealing with a transiently expressing cell line. You're really going to want to optimize a high production cell line with validated assays that show that this is produced the same each time within specifications, and making sure that you can remove viruses and endotoxins, characterize stability, scale up, and again, come up with a certificate of analysis. So you're going to be making and transitioning from research cell banks to master cell banks to working cell banks. And again, making both the drug substance and doing formulation work to come up with a drug product. And in the meantime, developing your own set of methods and validating them, which have a very specific meaning to make sure that you can have a pure product each time. Now, in the previous session, you've already heard considerable amount of information about toxicology. So I'll not repeat all that. I just want to talk to you about a few things that are important to consider as you move through SAFE. And one is, as you transition to SAFE, you're going to be thinking about different things with biologics and small molecules. Early on, you're going to be looking at BBB penetrance, P450 inhibition, cytotoxicity. With particularly with small molecules, you want to look at HER channel inhibition to make sure you don't have cardiotox issues. Eliminate those as soon as possible. As you develop these, you'll be looking at mutagenicity assays for small molecules. For biologics, you'll be looking at immunogenicity and thinking about making sure that you're not going to be neutralizing your biologics substance. It's one of the reasons why in monoclonals, we really had to focus on humanization. And now in many cases, we're coming up with fully human monoclonal antibodies. You're also going to be looking at tissue selectivity panels to make sure you're not having off-panel effects. And again, that requires good record keeping. There are differences in these drug development pathways. With small molecules, you're going to be doing a number of in vitro tests to look at mutagenicity, chromosomal aberration. Those are not generally required for biologics. But again, for biologics, you're going to be looking at anti-drug antibodies, particularly if they're neutralizing, and looking for activation of the immune system. Preclinical studies, as I mentioned, stop when you've transitioned to the clinical phase, but non-clinical studies continue. So as you can see with biologics, there are a number of safety studies that continue through phase one, phase two, and phase three testing. The same is true with small molecules. In fact, perhaps even more so. There's a number of tests that are required, particularly tests that require looking at embryonic development, reproductive toxicity, and some more chronic studies. So in the few remaining minutes, I want to spend a few slides on an area that always comes up in these talks, and that is, how do I can get around all this and reposition an approved drug or a drug already in use? And you may know that there are a number of examples of this in practice. One of the most famous is thalidomide, which was developed in 1957 in Germany for morning sickness for pregnant women. And then early in the 60s, it was discovered to our horror that it caused a lot of reproductive toxicity and included a number of limb deformities or lost fetuses. So it was banned in 62, but in 98 was repositioned for autoimmune complications of lupus. And even more recently was repositioned for multiple myeloma. A drug in MS, dimethyl fumarate, which is one of the first for oral administration, was originally developed as a mold inhibitor, was banned and then repositioned as Fumiderm, and most recently for relapsing remitting MS in 2013. And one of the most famous examples, that little blue pill, Viagra, which actually was repositioned halfway through its studies when an interesting side effect was discovered by nurses. So the potential advantages of this process is it can be cheaper and faster to build on prior data. But there are a couple of caveats. The safety characteristics can vary, and it can be hard to reposition the drug, particularly, for instance, if you're going from cancer drugs, which have a different tolerance for therapeutic window than neuro. Also, drugs may be protected by a composition of matter patent. You may not be able to use them yet, or by a use patent. Or you may face challenges of obviousness. Now, let's talk a little bit about the NDA, the end of this process. And the usual FDA development process, IND and development process I've been talking about, at the end gets an approval submission called a 505B1. But there is another process that was developed in 1984 called the 505B2, in which at least some of the studies were not conducted by the applicant. And that can sometimes allow you to reposition a drug because some or all of the supporting data can come from another source rather than your own. It can come from published literature or the drug master file that's already been filed by another company from the FDA. That can allow you to skip a phase one and sometimes phase 2A. It has the advantages of being faster and less expensive, but again, you may have limited coverage. So the way this has been developed by other companies can be shown in a study of submissions done between 2012 and 2016. An average of about 45 505B2 submissions were submitted to the FDA each of those years. But the majority were either new dosage forms, new combinations, or new formulations or manufacturing. So this does provide a path for existing drugs, but it may not allow you to position a new drug, a new proposal you're thinking of. So when in doubt, look at the FDA draft guidance on whether to submit an ANDA or a 505B2 application. Here's an example of how a company has used this in the neurological space, repositioning Narcan from an injectable form to a nasal spray. So again, this can really decrease the cost of drug development, and it can give you an extra 3 years of exclusivity, though that doesn't always provide you with enough coverage to recoup costs. So be aware that this can get you around some of the challenges of an IND and clinical development, but it isn't always the right shortcut. So in conclusion, drug development is really a relay race with a very slippery baton. There are a number of people involved in this, a number of processes involved. So wherever you are in this continuum, it helps to have the whole process in mind and work strategically. So in conclusion, begin with the end in mind. Keep strategic considerations in mind and work strategically to reduce risk, work tactically to optimize your lead, and don't screw up. And with that in mind, I'll go live and take questions. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Ted, for that wonderful overview. We're ready to take questions. about navigating the IND. I'm also a Gary Larson Far Side fan, so I always like seeing those exemplified. You know, you talk about, you know, start with the end in mind. And I think for many of the course participants, it's always, when do you get somebody who's got regulatory expertise involved? Are there, you know, and you have experience with this, but maybe provide an overview for how individuals, who do they contact, right? Would they talk to consultants? Would they, again, sort of scour the internet? Where are some good resources for individuals that want to start with the end in mind? Where do they go if they don't have a big pharma company supporting all these activities?
You know, that's a great question, Carl. I often caution people to follow Dante's advice, when in hell get a Virgil. You know, one of the best places to start is the FDA website. And it can be a little confusing to navigate at first, but they do have a lot of guidances, a lot of advice. So you can get a lot of information just off the web. At some point, you're definitely going to want to start working with an experienced regulatory consultant, you or somebody on your team. You can theoretically go to the FDA for either a pre-IND or a full IND application on your own, but there are a lot of regulations to know. There's a lot about the process, so it really helps to bring somebody in. And I think the balance always is, a lot of those people are expensive, and so how soon do you bring them in? I think this question of regulatory guidance is one of our big challenges in drug development. So my advice would be, familiarize yourself with the FDA website. Bear in mind too that the ICH guidances are also a good source to look through. And then, you know, talk to people who have done this before as well.
Right. I mean, it's a network, yeah. Right? I mean, yeah. That's one of the reasons we really welcome you as being a faculty member, because as a point of, you know, your plate might be full, but as a point of contact, you might be able to navigate for all the people here. I know I've had conversations yesterday about repurposing, which, as you pointed out in your slides, there's definitely pros and cons for repurposing, and you've got to navigate that. You've got to navigate that maze. And so, for those of you in there, you know, in the class that are thinking about repurposing, right, going from cancer to a neuro type of application, you've really got to. We talked about navigating dose and therapeutic window and a whole host of things. So,
exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, there aren't a lot of cases where people have repurposed drugs from cancer to neuro because of those therapeutic windows. You know, oftentimes you're looking to give people a couple of extra months of life, and in neuro we're looking for much longer treatments, and our tolerance for the toxicities is lower. If I take just a quick aside too, I was looking at the slides last night. My dog pointed out that on the IND categories, I mentioned emergency use and I mentioned COVID vaccines. What I meant to say was COVID treatments. Remdesivir from Gilead is a good example, an antiviral that did get accelerated IND consideration and has got experimental use authorization. But the vaccines have gone through a different process. So I didn't want to get a false impression there.
Right.
We all will be dealing with is the standard investigator IND. And if you're doing a research IND, there are cases where you can reference some of the CMC that's already been done by another group. The same is true for repositioning. You may have the opportunity to reference some work that's already been done when you're repositioning. But the question came up, how do you do combinations? If you're doing repositioning of a drug with another drug, yep, then it gets much more complicated. So repositioning may look like a fast track, and in some cases it is, but I think you really need to look into how you're applying the approved drug to a new use.
Yeah, the combination of already approved compounds or already approved drugs came up in my round robin, and I was, again, that's really, it's quite complicated. I mean, you've got, again, there's upside with everything, and there's also downside with everything. So we've got, Barb's got a question. Barb, would you like to unmute and ask Ted the question?
Thank you, Dr. Scheidt. Ted, I just had a question about, is it easier in other countries to get into first in human trials? Are the regulatory requirements any different? Or with the ICH harmonization, it's similar everywhere?
I think the ICH is making that a pretty level playing field. I will say that in the past, I inherited a drug for cancer that had been put into Eastern Europe and in New Zealand and Australia. And when the clinical trial results came out, the results looked very good in New Zealand and Australia, but in Eastern Europe, they didn't follow the protocols properly and actually had some deaths. So I think ICH is getting around that. There have been, in the past, people trying to get into certain countries because they were more lax. And in that case, it ended up with a good drug failing, didn't reach its clinical endpoint, and we couldn't partner it.
Yeah.
So I think that now there are strategies maybe for working in one country versus another, but I don't think there's any shortcuts in this process.
All right, thanks, Ted.
Yeah.
Well, we've got some questions, but we've kind of run out of time to stay on topic. Gonzalo's got a question.
Sorry for that.
It's not. But again, we'll have office hours afterwards. Gonzalo's got a really interesting question about where to find INDs. That you know, are there ways to again learn from those documents? And Ben's got another question about repurposing. So, guys, please make sure to interact with Ted at office hours later today, and you'll also be able to interact with him during the round robins. But I do want to keep us all on schedule. Keep the train moving forward because it is 1:50 on the East Coast and. That starts our next session. So Ted, thank you so much again for a delightful talk. I always like your graphics. I'm a sucker for all the, but anyway, nicely done. And we're gonna move on now to session 12, which is Shai Silverberg.
Hello, everyone. I'm sorry that we can't hold this meeting in person, but that's how things are these days. So I'll be talking about rigor and transparency, and I hope that this will not only serve you for your immediate goals, but for many years to come. But before we start, I have a disclaimer to make, and that is that opinions I will voice are my personal opinions and are not official opinions of NIH. And as you'll find out, I have many opinions. So a couple of years ago, Wang et al. Published a paper in which they reported that approximately 14% of candidate medicines that make it into phase one clinical trials are approved by the FDA. And this paper made a big splash. Now, you would think, you know, it makes a big splash because it's only 14%. But in reality, what happened was that this was a greater percentage than was reported previously for smaller sample sizes. And that was the big excitement. But when I read it, what came to my mind is 86% failure carved in stone, or could we do better? And I believe that we can. We can improve the chances of success. And therefore, my talk will focus on reasons for low success, measures taken to reduce attrition, and practices that we can embrace to improve the situation. So over the past 15 years or so, there have been numerous publications that claim that there are problems with the rigor and transparency of publications produced by the academic community. To give you just one example, in 2011, Bayer Healthcare published a paper in which they reported that two-thirds of projects that they initiated in the company that were based on papers published by the academic community could not be reproduced. Now, there are many reasons that could lead to this low reproducibility, and I will focus on the ones that I think play a major role, and they are human nature, lack of transparency, and the element of chance. So let's start with human nature. 400 years ago, Francis Bacon wrote that once a man's understanding has settled on something, it draws everything else also to support and agree with it. He went on to say that it is an innate and constant mistake in the human understanding to be much more moved and excited by affirmatives than by negatives. What I find so fascinating in this piece is that he refers to human understanding as a separate entity. He calls it it, as if it's not us. And I think, you know, we know that understanding most likely resides in the brain, and therefore I like the way the comedian M.O. Phillips put it when he said that, "I used to think that the brain was the one most wonderful organ in my body. Then I realized who was telling me this." So what M.O. Phillips, Francis Bacon, and many others are talking about are subconscious biases, where we think that we're have everything under control, but actually our brain is dictating other events. And there are many examples of and types of different biases. So how do we wrap our brain around it, so to speak? Well, I like the definition that was put forward by David Ranzoff, who said that the reliability of a study is determined by the investigator's choices about critical details of research design and conduct. In other words, he puts the onus on us as investigators to make sure that the experiments are as kosher as possible. However, he goes on to say that bias is unintentional and unconscious. So how can we reconcile these things? If it's unintentional and unconscious, how can we be responsible for it? Well, the solution he gives is really important to keep in mind, and that is, the process of addressing bias involves making everything equal during the design, conduct, and interpretation of a study, and reporting those steps in an explicit and transparent way. In other words, okay, we have to make sure that when we do an experiment, for example, looking at effect of drug and comparing it to a control group, that everything between the comparison groups are equal, with the one exception of the drug. Okay, and that's easier said than done. It's not simple, but we can do a lot better than we actually do these days in many cases. And I want to give you one example. So this is an experiment that was conducted more than half a century ago. It involved 14 rodents in the form of rats and 39 Homo sapiens in the form of students. Now, this ratio seems a little odd until one realizes that the experimental subjects here were actually the students. This was part of a course in experimental psychology, and the students were asked to train over a semester the rats to do different tasks and to monitor how fast they learn. And the students were told that the investigators breeded two types of rats: bright rats, very smart rats that learned fast, and dull rats that took much longer to learn. And the students knew before each experiment if they're going to be using a dull rat or a bright rat. Okay? And the results of the experiment are summarized here. You can see that, as you might expect, the bright rats learned faster. And this experiment was done with five different groups of students, and in all cases, the students found the same thing: the bright rats learn faster. There's just one problem with this experiment, and that is that there was no such thing as bright and dull rats. These were just rats taken randomly from cages. However, the students had the expectation that they will learn faster, and therefore that's the results they got. Now, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out what they could have done to prevent this from happening. All they had to do is not tell the students if they're going to be studying bright rats or dull rats. And that's something we call blinding. So blinding is actually an effective way to prevent expectation bias and other forms of bias. So how do people report whether they blinded the experiment or not? How often do they do that? Well, for that, we'll turn to an evaluation that was done by Malcolm McLeod and his colleagues at Edinburgh University, where they combed through many hundreds of papers in four disease areas: Alzheimer's disease, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's disease, and hemorrhagic stroke. And we'll focus just on multiple sclerosis because it had the largest number of papers. So they combed through 1,117 papers, and they found that only 16% of them reported on masking assessment of outcome. In other words, that the analysis was done in a blinded fashion. They also found that only 9% reported on whether they randomized the animals to comparison groups. And randomization is another important way to try to make sure that everything is equal between comparison groups, except for the one thing we are comparing. And finally, only two papers out of 1,117 provided information on how they came up with the sample size, which is pretty alarming. Okay. So what I've told you is that they, you know, it seems obvious that many do not report whether they blind or randomized or do other kind of measures that are important to minimize unconscious biases. But does this mean that they didn't do it? Well, that's difficult to answer, except there's indirect evidence that this might be the case. So in this study, again, the McLeod group, they combed through all the papers that examined the effect of the immunosuppressive drug FK506 in experimental stroke. And for each paper, they assigned a quality score. So for example, if the study reported on blinding, it got a point. If it reported on randomization, it got a point. If it informed how they came up with a sample size, they got a point. And so on and so forth, and they could accumulate up to 10 points, and that's shown on the x-axis. The y-axis reports the efficacy of the FK506 as it's reported in each one of these papers. And as you can see, there seems to be an inverse relationship. The fewer parameters that are reported, the greater the apparent effect of FK506, suggesting that lack of reporting is associated with lack of practice, and this lack of practice leads to bias. So why is this happening? Well, there are many potential reasons, and we don't have time to go through all of them. I'm going to focus on one which I think is a major contributing factor, and that's what I call the paper money, a vicious cycle. If you don't produce the papers, you don't get the money. So we all know that the way scientists are evaluated is by the number of publications and the so-called the impact these publications have. So we need to publish a lot, preferentially in high-profile journals, which would require that the studies will be novel, innovative, and significant. And this whole cycle to get the next round of funding is on average about 4 years in the United States. Now, is it realistic to expect that we will be able to produce such fantastic work every 4 years? I think not. So what happens is scientists rush studies to publication. Publications or projects that could have benefited from a couple more controls or perhaps more experiments to prove the hypothesis is, to test if the hypothesis is correct, or in other words, to try to get it to show that it's wrong, as opposed to trying to prove that it's correct. Or perhaps to use more, you know, larger sample sizes to make sure that the results are not due to chance. But the scientists don't have that benefit in many cases. And as a result, they rush studies to publication. And I want to give you one sad example. So it relates to the devastating disease ALS. And in the 1980s, scientists found that a small fraction of ALS patients have a gain of function in the superoxide dismutase 1 gene, the SOD1 gene. So this enabled them to generate an animal model. It's known as the SOD1 mouse model. And it's been used for many, many years to look for treatments for ALS. In 2002, a couple of groups reported that the antibiotic minocycline can dramatically increase the lifespan of the SOD1 mouse. Because it was a dramatic effect, and because the scientist, you know, ALS is such a devastating disease, the National Institute of Neurological Disorder or Stroke decided to fund a clinical trial to look at the effect of minocycline in ALS patients. This started 1 year after these papers came out. And 4 years later, the results were published and there was no beneficial effect of minocycline. So why am I telling you this? There's no reason to assume that things that work in animals necessarily will translate to humans. I'm telling you this because a year after the clinical trial was complete, the nonprofit ALS Therapy Development Institute published a comprehensive study that took more than 4 years to complete, in which they very rigorously evaluated more than 70 drugs in the SOD1 mouse model. Now, they did these studies so rigorously that they could detect a difference in the life expectancy between female and male mice on the order of a few days. However, they found absolutely no difference, no statistically significant difference between for any one of these drugs, okay, that was tested, many of which were previously reported to be efficacious, one of which was minocycline. Pretty amazing. They go on in this paper to say that the majority of published effects are most likely measurements of noise in the distribution of survival means as opposed to actual drug effect. This is just a very polite way of saying that the previous results were most likely due to chance. And this is a pretty audacious statement, and they certainly had to have a good reason to say it, and they did. They did a really cool experiment. Now, because they studied the SOD1 mouse model for more than 4 years and studying more than 70 compounds, they had many, many animals that served as controls. In fact, they had more than 2,200 such control animals. These were SOD1 mice that lived out their miserable lives in a cage and were never exposed to any treatment. And they knew everything about these animals. They knew when they were born, when they died, what this litter they came from, what sex they were, how many copies of the transgene they have, and what the cause of death was. And they put all this information into a database. And then they could run this in silico experiment, where they randomly selected animals from the database, separated them into two groups, and asked, what is the probability of seeing a significant difference between the life expectancy of these two groups, which of course by definition would be by chance because these are all control animals. And they define significant as a difference of at least 5%. Now, because this was an in silico experiment, they could run it tens of thousands of times to get really, really good numbers. And that's what I'm gonna show you now. So if they had four animals per group, and they adjusted the group for all the variables. They adjusted for sex and for litter and transgene copy number, et cetera, et cetera. They found that almost one in three experiments would give a rise to a misleading result. In other words, they would find a significant effect where there shouldn't really be one. Now you might say, who uses four animals per group? Well, you'll be surprised how many studies have on average 4 to 5 animals per group. If they had 10 animals per group, now approximately 1 in 10 experiments would lead to misleading results. And in the paper, they conclude that if one's doing experiments to look at survival of SOD1 mice, one needs to use 12 animals of each sex per group. Now this is not a magical number that should be translated to every other type of study, but it gives you a general idea of the ballpark of number of animals that probably are needed in various experimental setups. So now let's go back and look at the studies that actually led to the clinical trial of minocycline and see what they did. So the first paper was published in Nature, and I'm showing here the key figure from that study, and it is a survival plot comparing the survival of the control animals in a dashed line to those treated with minocycline, the solid line. And in this study, they used 10 animals per group, no mention of the sex of the animals, so if that was not adjusted for between the comparison groups, that could lead to a difference. There's no mention of randomization and no mention of blinding. A second study, again, similar kind of graph showing the survival. Here they looked at two different concentrations of minocycline and compared it to control. And they had 7 females per group, no mention of randomization. They do indicate that experimenter was blinded to the treatment protocol, which I don't really understand what it means, because one should really ideally blind every part of the experiment, from the allocation of animals to the conduct of the experiment and the analysis of the results. Now, because we know that if the study was done very carefully, there is no effect of minocycline, I think it would be fair to conclude that small sample sizes and or bias may have led to the apparent survival benefit of minocycline in the SOD1 mouse model that led to a human clinical trial. So if we take a holistic view on what I've shown you so far, there seems to be lack of transparency in reporting, deficiencies in experimental procedures that can lead to risk of bias, and there most certainly are perverse incentives. So how do we deal with that? Well, to improve transparency, we can improve the review of manuscripts of grants. As far as deficiencies in experimental procedures, we can improve awareness and education. Perverse incentives is a much more difficult nut to crack because that would require a change in culture. So as far as transparency is concerned, there are several journals that in recent years have required greater transparency in reporting so that the reader can see and assess whether the study was done carefully or not. As far as the review of grants, NIH made 4 changes, enhancement to grant review in recent years, that consists of 4 pillars. The first is the rigor of the prior research. The investigator has to evaluate and discuss the strengths and weaknesses of the key supporting data that they're using for their application in order to convince themselves and the reviewers that they're not building a house of cards. They also need to discuss the rigor of the proposed research to make sure that they are doing their best to minimize the potential risk of bias. They need to discuss biological variables, and they can be, you know, it's often referred to as biological variables such as sex, but there are also other kind of biological variables that they should take into consideration. And finally, authentication of key resources. We all know, for example, that there are many issues with the quality of antibodies. So what are you going to do to make sure that you're using high quality antibodies? Okay. What do we do about education, awareness, and culture? Well, NINDS plans to develop a platform, an educational platform for the principles of rigorous research. This will be a comprehensive set of educational tools that will be able to be used freely by the scientific community, and hopefully it'll lead to greater teaching of the principles of rigorous research, which we know are hardly taught these days. As far as changing the culture, we propose the establishment of communities of rigor champions in the institutions that will work together to try to bring about change. This is a grassroots effort. And if you're interested in joining this grassroots effort, you can apply to this email to join rigorchampions@nih.gov. So to summarize, what have I told you? I think the key take-home message is that we are all prone to bias. And as such, we have to critically assess results in publications. We have to, when we're reading papers, it's so easy to overlook flaws in the paper if they are supportive of our hypothesis and find fault in papers that do not support our hypothesis. We must rigorously design and execute and analyze experiments. And we should plan experiments to disprove the hypothesis. And finally, we should favor large effects. Now, wait a minute. I didn't say anything about effect sizes in my talk. And that was because we really don't have time to get into that. So I'll just leave you with one thought. The odds of winning the Mega Million jackpot is 1 in 302 million and change. Yet many people believe that they can win and they buy tickets, and some people do. The odds of being struck by lightning in the United States in a given year is 1 in 700,000. Yet many people are terrified of lightning, and some people do get struck by lightning. Yet we scientists assume that the odds of 1 in 20 is unlikely to happen by chance. Go figure. So with that, I thank you for your attention, and I look forward to our in-person virtual meeting where we can discuss this talk. Thank you.
Hello, Mike.
Hi, Shai. Thank you so much for that really lucid and compelling talk. I think we all realize now why it's so important to follow the principles of rigor and for our work to have impact. And of course, we all want to see the fruits of our labor be ultimately translated to positive benefit for patients. And the only way we're going to do that is if we pay attention to the principles that you discussed. So really, thank you for that. Do we have any questions? Not yet. So I'll jump in with an initial question here while we're waiting for the students to provide their own questions. And that is that I think researchers are sometimes concerned about the increased cost of performing studies in a rigorous fashion. And as I was listening to your talk, it occurred to me that many of the things you propose, such as blinding and randomization, they really don't cost anything. So that complaint is probably not really valid. On the other hand, there are some things that you propose that do increase the cost, such as having more controls or larger sample size or replicating studies and so forth. And so how do you respond to this concern that there isn't enough funding in a typical research grant to support all of the things that are required to do the study in the most rigorous possible way?
Thanks, Mike. That's a great question. First of all, a general comment. You know, I always say do less, but do it properly. For that we have to change the culture, so you don't have to publish 52 papers in 4 years in order to get your funding or the answer I'd give is, you know, as someone who works at NIH, there's no restriction on the amount of money that you can ask in a paper if it's well justified in a grant, if it's well justified. And you know, this notion that, oh, I've got to keep my budget down because I won't get funded. The budget is discussed after the score is given. It's not part of the score that goes into the grant application or a grant discussion. I think one should ask for what one really needs. But what that means is that when you're planning your 4 or 5 year project, you have to be realistic what you can accomplish in that time. You can't offer the world and in order to do that, you're going to have to, you know, rush studies because you're going to do small sample sizes and cut out a few controls, et cetera, et cetera. You have to be realistic. What can I accomplish in this next grant cycle? And how do I convince the reviewers that I'm going to do this in a very careful way? And that's why I need these resources.
Great. Okay. Thank you. We have a question from Costanza, who was fascinated by the example you gave from the ALS Institute, where they did the incredibly comprehensive and rigorous study of 70 drugs in the SOD mouse model. Costanza, you have a question related to that.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
So I'm wondering, because I'm usually funded by the NIA, and in that institute, they have the interventions testing program, where essentially researchers can nominate compounds or drugs to test lifespan extensions. So I was wondering if NINDS is maybe thinking about establishing or supporting that kind of testing for, you know, our research field.
So, that's a great question. And one needs to understand that, you know, NINDS has approximately 600 different diseases that they are responsible for. So clearly, you know, we cannot have something like that for every disease. We do have and have had for many years a testing facility like that related to epilepsy. And that has, you know, contributed over the years to supporting the progression of various drugs to the clinic. And more recently, they started in the area of pain. But this is all, you know, I mean, we obviously cannot have it in every possible area that NINDS covers.
So Ben has what strikes me as a really fascinating question. Ben, do you want to ask your question to Dr. Silberberg?
Sure. Good to see you, Shai. I'm actually giving a talk. I'm giving a talk next week at my university about transparency. So nice, good refresher from you. I appreciate it. So my question was about whether what I perceive as the stronger rigor often involved in human trial design can be back translated us to basic scientists. In other words, what can we learn from human trial design that will improve the rigor of our basic science studies? Any comments or thoughts?
First of all, the animal in general, you know, this is a 30,000 view, 30,000 foot view on the issue. The quality of research in animal studies lags behind the clinical trials by about two decades, something like that. It's a little sad, but for example, the consort guidelines came out, the original ones in 1996. If you think of, the ARRIVE guidelines, they came out into the original ones of 2010. Okay, so it gives you an idea kind of the difference we're talking about. The realization that there's lack of transparency in animal studies really only started around the turn of the century, whereas issues of the issues about surrounding blinding and randomization in clinical trials, you know, dates to the 1980s or so. So that's the reality. But one has to keep in mind that there are differences, okay? So one of my great revelations in the last month or so, which I'm very proud of, is that any experiment we do as scientists involves a vertebrate animal. And it doesn't matter if we're doing biochemistry, if we're studying yeast, there's a vertebrate animal in the experiment, and that's the experimenters, okay? And the biases I'm talking about and the issues are surrounding the vertebrate animal in the experiment, okay? So I mentioned this because in clinical trials you've got two vertebrate animals involved, okay? You've got the doctors providing the treatment, and you've got the patients. And that, of course, makes things a lot more complicated. So, you know, I hear arguments, people say, oh, how can I possibly blind? It's so complicated. But in reality, in the lab, it's not that difficult. I mean, many times you can just ask someone either in your lab or in an adjacent lab to blind the samples and only to reveal the code when everything is over. With humans, it's a lot more complicated. You know, you've got the doctors who hold the envelope up to the light to see what's in it and things like that, because, you know, the curiosity, you know, kills the cat. I think the main lesson I would say that you should learn from the clinical trials, because we have a lot more data there, is how important it is to blind and randomize and have clear inclusion exclusion criteria when you start, all these things that, you know, clinical trials typically use these days, okay? Clinical trials also pre-register everything, so you kind of know in advance what you're gonna do. I'm not sure it's realistic to expect that animal studies will do the same. So far, at least, it has not caught on because we kind of do different science, you know? I mean, I think when it's confirmatory studies that we do, like just pre-translation, or during translation, those probably should be pre-registered, just to make sure that you know your protocol, exactly what you're going to do, et cetera.
Yeah, thanks. We've actually been using, for any of our kind of studies related to, you know, drug development, we've been doing using the experimental design assistant from the UK to kind of pre-register those confirmatory experiments. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's a great tool. It's a great tool.
You know, Cheyenne, on that point, I wondered whether you could comment on the differences between, for example, exploratory work that somebody might do in the laboratory just to develop a hypothesis, and then a sequence of experiments that are intended to prove that hypothesis in a rigorous way.
Yeah, I'd say test the hypothesis, not prove the hypothesis. I mean, we should be trying to disprove the hypothesis in our studies. That's a very important question, Mike. So not all my colleagues would agree with me, but you know, I think that when one's doing exploratory studies, where you're looking for something, it doesn't always make sense to blind them, because a lot of times you don't even know what you're looking for. You're kind of just saying, will I find something? You know, so you kind of you almost have to be a little bit biased, because you're kind of looking for something that might be there and might not be there. Randomization doesn't a lot of time make sense. You're certainly not going to use large sample sizes, because you're looking for some kind of hints. But these hints will lead you with your intuition to an idea, you know, what we call an hypothesis. And if you want to now put your hypothesis to the test, you've got to try to get rid of all potential biases and to do things in the most rigorous way, okay? And so once you want to test your hypothesis, that's when the time comes to say, okay, I've got to blind, I've got to randomize, I've got to have a reasonable sample size. And you can use the pilot experiments that you did to come up with this idea to help you calculate what sample size you need, and not to pull a number out of the hat, but actually to get a good sense of what effect sizes you might expect and what variability you might expect, and then come up with an appropriate sample size. So those are important things to do. Now, there's nothing wrong with exploratory studies. In fact, they can be incredibly helpful for you and obviously for the community. The issue starts when people do exploratory studies and then publish them as confirmatory studies, okay? They have, you know, and that's, in my opinion, what happened with, for example, with the minocycline studies. They said, well, let's see if minocycline does something, okay? They got an effect, which could have been by chance or because it was, they were biased. And they don't report it as, look, you know, hey, we found something, you know, this will have to be tested more carefully, but, you know, here's what we found. They report it as a confirmatory study. And that, of course, is very dangerous and can waste a lot of resources.
Yeah. So I see that Ben here has shared with all of us a link to a website where you can pre-register your animal studies. And so that's great. And just on that last topic, I just wanted to ask you, Shai, how do you view research that you're doing that is in line with the general trend of research and accepted beliefs in the field versus kind of out there hypotheses that are kind of crazy and you get this result and it's not in line with everybody else's thinking. And it could really change the way we think about the science, but there may be a lower probability of it being true just because it doesn't go along with the current lines of thinking in the field. How do you view that?
Oh, that's the fun part. That's the exciting part. First of all, maybe it's my personality, but I have a hard time trusting my own work. So let alone others' work. So, you know, what the field like accepts as the dogma and so on, I tend to question, always. And I think that's good practice because in many cases, you know, things have been shown to be wrong. I mean, you know, that's how science progresses, basically. So if one has an exciting lead, that exciting to oneself, that goes against, you know, common understanding and so on, of course, one has to be incredibly careful of how one,
right,
you know, evaluates it, and you know, always ask the question, which I always ask myself, what did I do wrong? Okay, well, you know, I mean, I screwed up somewhere in the experiment. What did I do wrong? And then to come up with to test it in all kinds of ways, to in order to convince myself that this might be a real phenomenon.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have time for just one more question. And Philomena says, amazing talk. I completely agree with her. Philomena, would you like to ask your question?
Sure. So thank you. This was really amazing and eye-opening. I totally agree that human bias might be the biggest effect we see, but we see it also not just in the drug element in the experiments we do, but also in the review process in general for papers and for grants. So my question would be, first off, I wish you were my reviewer number two. So lucid and so genuinely asking for a question, but in general, do we see the improvement that the NIH is trying to make on the submitter side, on the investigator side, but what about the reviewers actually? Do you think that applying blinding or transparency, as we would do in the experiments, to the review process itself could help? And I refer to specifically having anonymous submission for papers might be easier than grants because the candidate needs to be evaluated too, but at least the first round of just evaluating the experiment and the project and not the person, not knowing where it's doing the experiment, because I think that's a huge bias, especially in fields that are very niche, small niches where everybody knows everybody, and then you have your favorites and you might mis-evaluate the work, or at least transparency where the submitter also knows the reviewers.
Yeah, so that's a, you know that's a very loaded and important question. I'll start by saying that what one has to keep in mind is that the reviewers are your peers, right? I mean, you know that. So it's fine that NIH asks, you know, that pay attention to blinding and randomization and all these things, but that requires that the reviewers also pay attention to it, because they are part of the community that is not reporting on blinding and randomization and you know, not doing these things. So it's going to take a long time, I think, before these changes that NIH made will actually become common practice. As far as blinding, personally, I think it's not going to work. It, you know, it can't really work because you're referring to your previous work. It's not only about evaluating you as an investigator. A lot of what you're proposing is based on your previous work. So how are you going to hide that? They have to evaluate not only you, they have to evaluate the environment where you're working. It's just, you know, I mean, I don't see it as being a realistic approach. We certainly have to do our best to you know, if there are such blatant biases, to root them out. And there are ways to do that. So for example, if there's a clear case of bias, then an appeal process can lead to re-review of the grant. But that's really, you know, kind of really the only way to deal with, you know, if there's blatant bias. A lot of times, unfortunately, you know, we all have our biases and they're not blatant and they kind of subtle. And that's part of the problem that, you know, we have to be reviewed by humans. You know, I've been involved in in reviews in three continents. And I can tell you that the system in the US is still the best of all of them. So it's far from being perfect, but it's a lot better than the European system or the system that I came from. I can assure you that.
Okay, well, on that very optimistic note, we're gonna thank Shai. And we will now take a slightly less than 15 minute break. We'll reconvene at 2:45 Eastern for the round robin session. So see you in a few moments.
Okay, thanks to you all, and thanks, Mike.
Thank you so much, Shai. Really appreciate it.